he went, he said, looking forward to it. He went, no, it's going to be boring. Suzanne was listening, knows that the couple were taping the show, so she had to get in there before you, didn't she? She went up to him and said, look, when you're listening to the show and he says it's going to be boring, he didn't mean you, he meant weddings in general. I love the fact she has to run around and clean up after him. It's great, isn't it? How was it?
Do you not like weddings? You're not a fan of them?
They're only good for the people involved, aren't they?
What are you talking about? You're getting free food, free booze, free music?
Yeah, but it's not, it's just all the hanging about and there's loads of people there you don't know.
Absolutely, so, I agree.
Do you know what I mean? You've got to make an effort.
Yeah.
And even the bit that was important, right, when they were getting married, right, there wasn't enough chairs, because it was, you know, all the family gets the chairs, don't they? So I was sort of stood
selfish
at the back. Stood at the back of that watching, and I couldn't hear what was going on, because a woman was breastfeeding the baby.
Oh!
But what, how loud was this baby? Because he was, you couldn't hear what was going on?
Yeah, so it was slurping and that, and she was like, I just thought, how hungry is it?
Could it not have waited?
Because you've all got to wait for the buffet or whatever later.
Yeah, I know.
But also just in this.
Well, there was two, up, wasn't there? What did you? Why didn't you else?
The only thing that annoys me with weddings is the gift. Is the gift thing. Because, like, you buy these gifts, right? You spend a little bit of money, maybe. You know, I like to be a little bit lavish if I go to a wedding.
Come on,
you get a gift, right? You package it up.
You're
and I don't know about you, Rick, but I like to see the response. When I give a gift to someone, I want to see that, the feedback from that. You know, this is very much, you know,
I want to see what it is that Jane bought them on, you know, and put my name to it.
Yeah.
Because sometimes I go, oh, thanks for the, I go, oh, no worries,
no worries, yeah, no worries.
Yeah. But, you know, certainly, I mean, we've talked about it before, but certainly, you know, it's the amount of money spent and the amount of time given to the gift should be correlated by the amount of the response you get.
Absolutely.
If I give a book token, a shrug is fine. But if I give, you know, a sizable, I want them to be showing it to friends, if it's a bar, I want them to show it to the barman.
Yeah, you want to go, look what Steve Merchant got me, yeah. He's the greatest man in the world.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You go to a wedding, you turn up with a gift, you could have spent, you know, upwards of £15 on it. You turn up, you walk in, you say, excuse me, where's the bridegroom, I want to give him this gift. And some bloke, normally the brother-in-law, says, oh, yeah, no,
brother-in-law's mate.
Yeah, sorry, they're too busy to see you right now. Just stick the gift on this big table with all the other ones.
Yeah.
And they'll get back to you
in a week.
It may be 6 to 8 weeks after the honeymoon. They maybe write you a note. They won't thank you personally. They'll write you a note.
It'll be a general thank you.
It's general thank you.
Your name in different type.
Yeah, but it might have some vague reference to, you know, to what you did. But it won't really be personalised.
Yeah. The set of mugs, again, will be in different types.
Exactly.
Thank you, Steve Merchant, for your wonderful gift. We love mugs. Yours.
Exactly. And a photocopied signature.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah, it's not right, is it? Oh, dear.
And also, of course, as well, if there's a baby involved, you know, perhaps they had a kid out of wedlock, that's where they're getting married, there's normally a little baby signature as well. Like the baby signed it. From Paul and Sharon and little Billy.
Ben, these days. I reckon. What do you think, Carl? How was the wedding, by the way?
Did you find
you? Suzanne sorted something out.
Yeah. What?
Actually, no, we're going away. I'm going to walk away with them.
That's your gift?
Yeah. What, you're going away? No, we're going away to Cornwall or something, yeah, that's it. We've sort of paid for a place to stay in there. Come along and that.
And their gift is to spend a week with you in a confined space.
Oh, yeah, they'll have a great time with that.
Will they?
Yeah, it's fine.
Can I get a pen? I'm making a note of how many times you say "and that" during today's show. And so far, there's three. I've noticed three. I'm just gonna go and make a note because I think we can have a competition here. If you can predict how many times he's gonna say "and that," and the closest one wins some of the crap DVDs that we've got on offer.
Hold on, tell me we've got a lad of 49.
Definitely.
Landed. Ben Folds on XFM 104.9.
We've had an email, Rick, from Simon Whittaker. He says, he's throwing the question to Carl. Have you seen the video for that Ben Folds song where there's apparently a monkey working the sound desk and shifting the piano? Yeah, you want to check that out. Talking of monkeys working the sound desk, we've also had a lot of emails directed at you. Yeah, a lot of emails directed to you, Carl, asking if you saw this programme that was on in the week the, no, I think, I didn't see it, I think it's called
The Strangest Village in Britain. Yeah. Did he watch it? He called me six times during it.
Now just explain briefly what this was, because I didn't see it.
Well, it was, a sort of an experiment, for, I think, I can work out from the sort of 70s, and it was sort of run by, from what I can make out, mainly sort of German, Christians.
Right.
And, what it was, people with various disabilities, mental illnesses, Down syndrome, autism, bewildered, you know, and they were living normally in the community. And there was 300 people in the village, half, had some sort of, problem, mental problem or disability, and the other half were sort of carers. And, I mean, you know, it was very, very strange.
And where is this village? It's somewhere in this village.
It's up near Whitby, isn't it?
Right, okay.
But he called me at various points, he was watching that, and just started off, he went, geez, if that's the beginning, what have they got coming up? Then there was two fellas, and the phone rang, and it went, what is going on? And it was two, blokes who had created their own language.
Okay.
And they were going, what do I do? And you go, what do we do? And you know, it was an interesting programming. I love documentaries like that. But what made it twice as good was that I knew that Carl was getting confused.
Yeah.
There was one bloke that went round interviewing people, and you just have a string of questions, and you go, have you ever had curly hair? What's your favourite animal? Have you ever seen a badger? Alright. And, Carl was getting stressed.
It was stressing out.
Because I was trying to think of the answers quickly enough.
Yeah, he was sort of saying, you know, do you like mosaics and that, and I was like, oh dear. And the next question was coming in. It was like Malik's mallet. You know, that sort of that word association thing. I was stressing it out.
But he said he wanted to go there. He actually said, oh, could I go for a holiday there? And I went, well, I doubt that. I don't know. Maybe you could go on a visit. You know, oh, that would be great, wouldn't it? For Carl to walk in there.
But the thing about it would be like, Carl would be the ruler. He'd be the king. It would be that, in the kingdom of the blind, the one-eyed man is king. I mean, he would just die.
I don't know, there was someone who was quite clever.
Really?
Yeah, I don't think he'd, I think he'd probably be average.
Yeah.
I don't think he'd.
Okay, he'd come in.
No, I don't think he'd shine. Because
yeah.
A lot of them were quite good at some things, but no. He didn't like the angry bloke who punched him. There was a, this really sort of sweet Down syndrome woman called Nan. And, she hadn't hung her coat up, and this angry, bloke was going, if you don't hang your coat up, I will. And he punched her, didn't he?
Yeah.
And poor Nan got it in the neck from everyone. There was another woman bullying her, wasn't he? That, yeah. But you like the little, The little dancing to a fellow with a woolly hat who was helping that woman.
If I went now, he's the one who had sort of hunt down and said, come on, let's go for a pint or something.
Sure.
But,
incidentally, do you like mosaics? We didn't establish that. He's still thinking about it.
What was his name, that one? Do the woolly hat that you liked and you wanted to hang around with? What was his name? I can't remember. He was good, I liked him, he was nice, wasn't he?
Yeah.
He's the one that fell over, then proposed marriage to that woman, didn't he?
Yeah. I remember, I was on a, I don't know if this is alright to talk about, I mean, it happened, so, you know, not
really. This is alright to talk about, everything's alright to talk about.
But I was on the train, right, coming from Manchester back to London, right?
Yeah.
And, got on it, it was like a Friday night, and it was heaving, you know, like the last train is and all that. And, absolutely chocker. Right?
Yeah.
So I'm walking through the carriages, thinking, oh, is he in his seats anyway? Anyway, everyone's like, it's heaving, right? It's people stood up in the doorways, you can't get in the toilet and all that. There's not going to be any chair knocking about. You know, so walking through, and anyway, I see this one empty chair sort of in front of me, right? Think, oh, why ain't anyone sat there? Right? I'll just rush to that, get to that, get myself a seat, plonk myself down, right? And, sort of turn round, you know, see who I'm facing, you know, see who you're sort of having a chat with. Little fella there, right? Little, Down syndrome kid.
Right. Right.
Sat there. And, he goes, alright. And I thought, oh. Right. Not bad, but do you know what I mean? They're always talking, aren't they? They ask a lot of questions. Right, so I was like, oh, here we go, 2.5 hours. And I couldn't get up because the thing is, that's obvious.
Sure.
Right. So that's like mean. I never want to be mean, do you know what I mean?
No.
At the end of the day. So, so anyway. So I think, I know, I'll go to sleep.
Clever.
Right, so I shut my eyes, and he leaves me alone and that. So, so then, my phone goes, and I think, right, what do I do? Do I ignore it? Or do we open the eyes and see who it is? Anyway, open the eyes, it's Ricky calling about something. About nothing, probably, actually, thinking about it. It wasn't even worth answering, right? So anyway, but I'm awake now, aren't I? So he's like, hello. And I'm like, all right, mate. And he says, you're muscly.
Oh, God!
And, I said, yeah. And he goes, you know, why? So I said, no, just don't. It's, again, stressing me out, because I'm thinking, why am I? Why am I muscly? I don't go to the gym. And, you know, I mean, I'm not muscly, I'm in good shape. And that.
Well.
So, he wants an arm wrestle. On a cram train from Manchester, so I've got another hour and a half of this.
Well, so, you talked back, he'd soon got up and left. If you'd have started asking him questions, he'd have got up and left with a dribble you come out with.
So anyway, do you know when you're under pressure, you're thinking, well, he's said that I'm muscly, right, so do I do it or not? What, and there's people watching, you know, not joining in, not sort of having a laugh and that with me, just like watching but pretending they're not.
Oh,
and I'm
God.
At one of those table seats, so it, and he kept saying, come on, what arm wrestle? So, and it was getting loud, and I thought, oh, I best just start an arm wrestle.
What do you mean? I best just have an arm wrestle! What do you mean?
Get it over and done with. I had to. If he's gonna keep asking, I had another hour and a half on the train.
Oh, God.
So, anyway.
Oh, my God. I'm thinking he won.
Well, were people putting bets on? How was it working?
It was stopped, and just as well, really.
He was
winning, I was struggling a bit, right?
Yeah.
And he was really, like, you know, taking my arm down, and then he sort of let go and started laughing. And I thought, thank God he let go, because I would have made, you know what I mean? If I lost that, everyone's in the train looking, and all the rest of it.
It's something serious, yeah. Doing. He's got to win this. Who can turn?
But then he just, then we were chatting about favourite food and that, he likes sausages. And I said, you know, he said, do you like sausages? I said, yeah, they're alright, I like a bit of Chinese and that as well. And he was saying, oh, I can't have Chinese, I'm not allowed Chinese.
Why?
Dunno, he just said, it's not allowed to have it. But yeah, I had a good long chat about stuff and that, but...
So you enjoyed it in the end?
In the end, it was all right. Yeah, it's just.
What do you expect?
Okay.
No, but it's that thing, isn't it? It's whenever you're faced with something different,
yeah.
It's always awkward, isn't it? And that's the thing.
You're talking about him now, are you?
And I think I did all right because everyone else was ignoring him, but
yeah.
I probably made his day pretty good.
Yeah. Who else spoke?
I like the idea that newlywed couple are probably thinking that's going to be a similar journey down to Cornwall.
Forever lost. I was taken unawares because I opened that thing. What is it?
The confectionery.
Well, we were sort of doing it ironically, like people getting shameless plugs by giving us stuff. But then I opened it, and it's brilliant.
It is brilliant.
It's all retro stuff. It's got a curly whirly, a fountain, sherbet fountain. I've just been eating a drumstick, but I didn't quite finish in time.
It's got some of those little cola bottles.
That's Hope and Greenwood and their confectionery, which are the perfect summer gift, perhaps you've got to go to a wedding or a barbecue party.
And we've got some rubbish to give away now, haven't we?
We have indeed, yeah. If only we hadn't opened that, we could have thrown that in the mix.
I know, no, it's too good to give away.
It's time for Rockbusters, the quiz that no one looks forward to. And we've got, as usual, the bunch of CDs, DVDs, I should say, which...
Just tell me we have got another copy of Ladder 49.
Ladder 49's right here. That's
brilliant.
In the mix, yeah.
How many did I send you?
Joaquin Phoenix, John Travolta, Ladder 49, the movie that no one's seen.
Yeah.
I've never met anyone who's seen it.
But is owned by every single SFM listener.
Exactly. Also in the mix, as I said before, we've got Priscilla, Queen of the Desert, which, if you haven't seen that on telly, I'd be very surprised. French and Saunders at the movie, the best of all the French and Saunders movie spoofs, which is, I think, on TV every single night.
Yeah. It's a very gay giveaway so far.
It's
isn't
a very gay. Well, this
one,
this
49, the people in uniform, you've got Queen of the Desert and French and Saunders,
well,
the gays love them.
You know how much a fellow of Chevy Chase, you know I love Chevy Chase.
Yeah.
Well, we've also got here National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation 2, which doesn't feature Chevy Chase. It was so bad, even Chevy wouldn't agree to be in it, so instead, Randy Quaid, who plays Cousin Eddie, it's him.
Right.
And on the back right notice it says special appearance by Eric Idle.
Brilliant.
I mean, let's be honest, if a film's got a special appearance by Eric Idle,
I know.
It's probably not a classic, is all
I'm
saying.
Do you reckon they do Always Walk on Anyway,
that's just some of the DVDs which you can win. And obviously the real reason you should enter is because you go forward to this big prize draw, which is in our last show, where you can win some actual quality.
A signed, Matt Groening drawing. And if you can see him drawing that on RickyGervais.com, it's totally genuine. It's there, him actually drawing it in front of your very eyes. Also, made us, flannels, and a signed, poster by Nigel Tufnell. Christopher Guest.
Sure.
So proper good prizes.
Yep.
So this is, I think it should be the last one to get into it. Maybe next week, the four that we've got get down to two, maybe. And then we get them on the line in the last, what do you think?
Well, I'll be honest, I wish we'd thought it through. I don't know about you, but I wish we thought this
Chris Campling, if he's got any ideas yeah. to how this show could have run, see, we should have scripted this.
What we said, we just said the go in a drawer, didn't we?
Did we? Yeah, we hadn't thought it through, though.
But we can't keep swapping and changing.
Well, we haven't done it yet. We can do what we want, yeah. We can have any BAFTAs we've won. We can do exactly what we want.
High five.
Well, listen.
Six.
Well, let's get down to business then.
Right, so Rob, let's explain briefly what this quiz is for those that have only just started listening to the show.
It's basically Blockbusters.
Well, you say that, Rick, but it's not, is it? I mean, that Blockbusters made sense.
Yeah, well, there's this thing that Carl thinks this is a cryptic clue going right. A fella is walking along and, oh, look, there's the fish. What does that mean? D-trout, no, sinners.
Some of them are hard because they've dug them all out.
Some of them are hard because
no, but they've dug them all out because they're going to put them all on the website for people to play along with, and they came to me for the answers. And some of them are pretty tricky. I couldn't answer them.
So, oh, I love that.
Anyway,
the only man that can outwit himself.
Right, so the first one, then. Here we go. Why don't you borrow some land off Mr. Boardman or Mr. Laurel or Mr. Fletcher? Alright? Why don't you borrow a little bit of land?
Oh, it's changed already.
Already changed.
Yeah, already changed.
Mr. Boardman.
Well, no, do it again and do it exactly the same each time. Do it again.
Why don't you borrow some land off Mr. Boardman or Mr. Laurel or Mr. Fletcher if you need a bit of it?
What's changing?
Okay,
and
what's
right.
What are the initials?
Right, LS.
LS.
LS. That's a band or an artist. Who am I talking about? Second one.
Sorry, he's got a sweet in his mouth.
I'm gonna annoy those seabirds over there. Right.
I'm gonna annoy those seabirds over there.
Oh, just those seabirds. It doesn't matter where they are. I'm gonna annoy them seabirds.
I don't know what he's talking about anymore, Steve. Honestly.
B is the initial.
I love the fact that he was fascinated by the strangest village in Britain. But the stories he told us about where he comes from, there's him going around with two fellas with big heads, webbed feet, a little pigeon-chested bloke, him on his grifter with Maggie pecking at him, his dad in the telephone box nicking groceries, and a horse in the house next door. I mean, how strange was his upbringing? Yeah. And him hanging from his satchel. Unbelievable.
There's another woman who I remembered. Actually, I'll tell you later.
Go on, I'll tell you later
about another woman who I remembered.
What is this? Give us a teaser.
It's just a woman who rode around on a three-wheeled bike with her husband in a basket. Right, I'll tell you about that. Right, and the final
You don't get teasers like that
on the other radio
station. That's a hell of a funeral service.
Oh. Right, listen. Right, the final clue. What the Scouse fella said to the robber who he found in his house next to his vineyard.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
What? Again.
Right, so what the Scouse fella said.
Right, this is going to be a pronunciation thing.
To the robber he found in his house.
Oh, God. I've lost the will to live. I want to get in that woman's basket on the street. We'll just be driven mad.
The initials there, AW. AW. Who is it?
Right. Well,
email in and that. Mm.
Should we have also on the text 83XFM? You can win Christmas Vacation 2 and Ladder 49.
Yeah, what's that, man? David Bowie, watch that man on XFM 104.9. Now, coming up, Steve. And listeners, I'm talking to them mainly. I'm not really, I'm talking to you and Carl, really.
Yeah.
But, coming up, an old feature, Knob News.
Oh, Knob News, the welcome return of Knob News.
Yes, and, Monkey News is still there, isn't it?
Yeah.
Just briefly, you don't think you really gave that, competition justice, did you, not handing out the email?
No, let's just quickly whiz through the questions again.
Yeah. John's texted in, by the way. He says, I never get any of the Rockbusters clues. Is this a good or a bad thing? Definitely a good thing.
Definitely a good thing.
Yeah.
Well, other people do.
Well,
first one. Why don't you borrow a bit of land off Mr. Boardman or Mr. Laurel or even Mr. Fletcher?
Right.
L.S. Second one. I'm gonna annoy those seabirds. Right. B. And the last one. What the Scouse fella said to the robber he found in his house next to his vineyard. A.W. If you know what they are, email in or text in.
Tell us about the woman. What's the text? Quick,
well, 83936 on the text. Okay. Ricky.gervais@xfm.co.uk on the email and that.
Alright, and that.
Matt, I'm going to make a note of that.
And that. Right, tell us about this woman.
Well, it was just because you were saying about the, you know, our
living. We are broadcasting now, aren't we? This is actually going out, this is live. This isn't us sort of like.
Yeah, but you were just talking about how I lived in an odd village.
Yeah.
With kids with big heads and all that, right? And what I wanted to do.
What is that again? There's two kids with big heads.
Yeah, they just had sort of big heads and webbed hands and that. They went to my school. And when I spoke to my dad the other day, because I'm going to see my mum and dad tomorrow.
Oh, yeah.
So I said, oh, have we got any school sort of school photographs with the big-headed kids in? And he said, nah, no, nobody bought those sort of school photos because they were in it, so it was always a bit ruined. But I said, well,
no.
No, he said, sales were, you know, because he obviously talked to other dads and stuff like that, and he just said, oh, no one bought them. But anyway, so
I would love them.
Yeah.
I swear I'd buy them.
Yeah, but I wouldn't stand out, would I?
If you found the mantelpiece.
Yeah, well.
Hmm. So I was talking about, you know,
when you say they had big heads, what do you mean? Do they look like someone from Doctor Who?
They were just quite big.
But they weren't related?
No.
So why are you two blokes with big heads and webbed feet?
I lived in a weird area. There was a chemical plant close by.
I can't believe you've never told us that before. That explains a lot. Not just the freaks in your neighbourhood, but
no,
well,
there was loads of weird stuff going on. There was this, like I said, there was this woman who used to like live in one of the council flats, right? And she had a three-wheeled sort of big, what do you call
son.
It?
Three-wheeled son. He was the weirdest bloke we ever knew.
Well, he got like a big tricycle, but for an adult rather than one for a kid. It was a big one.
It wasn't a motorbike though. It was a
It was a push bike thing.
Yeah.
And she used to sort of ride down the road with a fella sat in the basket on the back with his like legs dangling over. And they'd be going to like the pub and what have you.
Was it a different fella each time or the same one?
Yeah. Sort of bolded fella.
So it was in collection for like organs and things. Bring out your ill. And they would just people just throw granddad just in the back and go, right, we'd get £4 for granddad.
But she's
got a lovely pair of testicles on him. They're very low, but they're extremely
like you're dead or nearly dead.
She used to pick on her husband quite a lot. They'd be in the pub and what have you, and they'd be sat by themselves, but she'd always be sort of, you know, having a go at him, moaning at him, sort of pushing her about and that. So my dad and his mate, right, they went round to the house, knocked on the door, she answered, and he said he was a copper, right. He said, you know, Detective Pilkington, gonna come in and have a word.
So I'm just gonna make a note of impersonating a police officer.
for the good, he went in and sort of now I've heard, you know, you're picking on your husband a lot. Yeah. We'll be keeping an eye on you. Do it again, and there'll be trouble. And she backed off after that. She
That's
was
good.
Right.
And that was the husband. Was he still in the basket though? Was he allowed to ever sort of like ride up front with her? Or was he just always
she'd sort of stop picking on him in public places and stuff.
That's
like
good.
You can't get done, can you, just for doing that?
I think impersonating a police officer.
Well, you probably did. There was no gain. I think you can't impersonate a police officer full stop. But I think they'd probably be lenient on him that he was, you know. But let's face it, he's not going to be caught because why would anyone know? But it's not like his son's going to say it on a radio station, is it? And stitch him right up.
Is this something you did generally? Kind of a little bit of like vigilante work?
Just whatever, and his mate, just, you know, if they saw something going on, they go, what can we do? Sure. A little scam can we do or whatever.
That's fantastic! That is brilliant! Right, okay, coming up, Knob News.
And Monkey News.
And Monkey News. And the answers to Rockbusters. What a show. I'm not sure of what I
I'm sorry. FM by Snoop Doggy Dogg and Justin Timberlake and a bunch of other people. Mm. Ricky Gervais, Steve Merchant, Carpenter. And sorry, I was just enjoying that Hope and Greenwood confectionery.
Lovely.
But I wish I had something to wash that down with, Rick.
Well, you have a glass of lovely Ban Rock Station red wine.
Oh, lovely.
It's barbecue friendly.
Yeah, perfect.
Good, so just keep sending stuff in.
Free stuff, please, free stuff.
Good stuff. Carl. What are we talking? Oh. What are we doing? I've got something to tell you, actually. You know we've teased Steve about, not ever spending any money.
Careful, I'm careful with money, I'm not-
Yeah. Guess what? He's treating it like, he's nurturing this, right? Like, he keeps running off, right? In the edit. He's having a suit made, and he wants to be just right, because I reckon he's forking out quite a lot. He's having a suit made. Think of that, him.
Let me tell you this, though. I don't want you thinking that I'm getting all flash with my cash. It's very hard to buy off the peg when you're 6'7". So, you know, it was a necessity. Carl, I don't want you thinking that this is the beginning of some new phase.
Well, is everything you buy something out of measure?
No, I'm afraid if only. If only I could afford it, mate. But, no, I'm off the peg generally, but...
Is it like properly done and that? Just...
Oh, yeah, it's the full thing. The full works. Gotta keep going back for fittings, they've got that little bit of chalk, you know, the pins.
It's where I had mine made, you know how good I look all the time.
Did you have to have that, thing done where they say, what side do you wear your member?
What side you dress? They don't say what side you wear your member. That would hardly be a euphemism, would it? So they say what side you dress, sir. It means what side your little pokey little, your little John Thomas leans, doesn't it, on rest, usually to the left, isn't it? Your little left testicles.
If I said to you now, what side you wear, do you know?
It would be left. It would be the left. That's what I mean. If standing there, right, with nothing restricting it or holding it in or holding it up, right, it sort of leans, your one ball is sort of like slightly back and lower, isn't it? And your little John Thomas rests there, so it's left. And the reason they ask it is so they don't put the tape measure up on the left and swash your willy or touch your willy.
So it's nothing to do with like, well, you'll need a bit more room of sort of more material on that side, or...?
Well, no, I don't think they compensate. It's just when they put the... when they stick that up into your groin, they don't want to come in contact with your
The thing is, I don't know what side I wear stuff on. I just sort of pull my pants up and wherever it wants to go that day.
But maybe it's not big enough to sort of make any, you know, real decision.
But, like now, I'm sat here, right, with my jeans on. I don't know where I am.
Well, that's clear from hearing you talk.
No, but what I mean is, if a fella said to me, what side are you, you know, what side's your member on?
Member? What is this the use of the word member suddenly?
Well,
it's usually not appropriate, and also, I imagine in the old days they had big baggy pants and used to sort of like hang down, and now, you know, like with those stretchy boxers and briefs, it's sort of held up in a nice little, neat little parcel, isn't it? So it's probably not appropriate, it doesn't come in contact with your little snake. So, you know, are you telling me a tailor has asked you that and you went, what do you mean, mate?
No, I've never, I've not really had one made to measure. I had one made when I was a kid. But since then, I've sort of bought a suit off the hook. But when you were saying about buying a suit, I know that question sort of crops up and I don't know what the answer is. It just annoys me the way there's no surprises anymore. Do you know what I mean? People know.
What do you mean? He's gonna go, right, I'm gonna measure you now. Which side's gonna measure? Go, well, pot luck, go and have a look. Like, they go, oh, you got it.
Do you mean there's no surprises anymore? What are you talking about?
Everything you say is a surprise. Everything you say, every opinion you have, is a surprise to me.
What I mean is, why aren't people just happy just to go, well, depends, isn't it? I'll just pull the pants up wherever it wants to go, I'm happy.
What do you mean? Why is this such a big issue?
But Carl, when they ask you this question, they're not making a note of it somewhere. It's not statistical research to find out what the kind of common leaning is. It's just, it's a question so he doesn't touch it when he's using his tape measure.
Just be careful.
But he is being careful by asking the question.
But what's wrong with him touching it anyway?
Hello.
It's like...
Fair enough.
But if he just sort of, you know, knocks it a little bit, you can just go, oh.
Do that again?
To me, it's the same as the prostate thing. It's just happening all over again.
It's but the doctor doesn't go, oh, what side's your arse on, sir? Trying to avoid the arse. He wants to go, he knows where your arse is and he's aiming for it and he wants to get it up there. He's aiming for it for a good cause. This little fella's going, well, I've got to measure his leg. I don't want to touch the knob. I just ask him, sir, do you mind telling me where your cock is so I can avoid it?
It's a big difference.
But like I'm saying to you, I'd have to have a look first. To let him know. I don't know where it is now. I don't know, it could be the left, could be the right.
Are you telling me you can't, you don't know where your knob is now?
Without looking.
Well, how would you mean without looking? How could...
Well, you're saying it as if like...
Should we have a guess?
Well, have a look and tell us where it is.
And what are you wearing? What sort of pants are you wearing?
I've got my jeans on.
But you've got pants on underneath them?
Yeah.
What are they? Briefs? Or boxer shorts?
Boxer shorts.
Boxer shorts. Well, it's probably free, but the jeans are probably stricken it. I think it's probably either in the middle, resting, or just slightly to the left. Have a look, we'll tell the listeners after the break, where's Carl's knob?
Oh, brilliant. We've got to send this to the Sony Awards people.
Run, Snow Patrol on XFM. Well, big question. Where was Carl's knob?
That's what people have been hanging on for.
Yeah. Where was it?
Well, I can't believe people have been texting in.
Hey, well, guessing where it is.
People saying, is it in the middle? Is it in the left? Cost them 10p. Answer 10p to find out. Just wait, I'm gonna give out the answer. You don't win anything, right? Let's strike it lucky. Right,
bottom or middle? Right.
It was to the left.
Oh! Yeah.
I went with the right, that's annoying.
See, I thought it would be to the left, if not, maybe if it was all scrunched up, sitting down on your lap, right, it might just pop up to the middle, just pop out, like, you know.
Sort of next week, we'll be finding out where yours is.
Where's Ricky's balance?
Right then, which leads us nicely into...
Knob News.
Oh, it's the welcome return of Knob News.
Right, okay, it's very much like the news at 10, this, isn't it? Mm. I do a bong, or in this case a schlong, and he gives me the headlines, the knob news of the day. The big, where have you connected all this knob news? Was there a lot of knob news this week?
It was mental this week. stuff. The way it works, you give us the bong, yeah. I'll give you the headline,
okay.
Steve decides which story's going to talk about.
And now on XFM, knob news. Schlong.
Man grows knob on his arm.
Schlong.
Man gets doctors to make him a second knob.
Schlong.
Turkish prisoners made hole in cell wall to produce third inmate.
Schlong.
Doctors accidentally remove man's testicles.
So, can I straight away go for the accidental removal of the testicles?
Well, it's happened before, haven't it? We've talked about that before.
What did you go in for a tonsillectomy? And he went in the wrong way. What are you talking about? How can they accidentally remove his testicles?
It says he didn't look at his folder, and the doctor said to the fella, "We've removed your testicles, and we wanted to take out your prostate gland." So, that's what happened. There's a story. This is what I mean, that's why I don't like going to the doctors.
Yes!
It happens, doesn't it? Because all these sort of, it's when they say things like, oh, it's just, we do loads of these operations. That's when they're not concentrating.
Brilliant.
Do you know what I mean? When they say it's procedure. That's like having a boring job that you do every day when you're not going to be concentrating. I prefer them to go, this is a tricky one, this.
I sort of do know what you mean.
But you watch TV programs about, like, you know, removing someone's second head or whatever, and it's like the best surgeons from all over the world.
It's televised, they can't make a mistake. They can't go, we took his legs off by mistake.
Whereas the fella who's having a prostate's like, oh, do you want to do it? I'm sick of doing them.
Yeah.
And they're probably doing a crossword whilst writing it.
Of course they are. I've seen that actually in operating theatres. They're doing a crossword.
That's what I mean.
Yeah.
I was just examining some of the other knob news, Rick, a little bit more closely. Mm. Man gets doctors to make him a second penis. I'm sure we're all interested in what happened there. A German who persuaded doctors to give him a second penis has lost his wife after he showed her the result. Biker Michael Gruber lost his original penis in a motorbike accident, and doctors built him a second one using a mixture of skin, bone, and other tissues.
Bone?
Apparently. The penis works so well that he was even able to father a child with his wife Bianca, but Gruber was still not happy and asked doctors to repeat the operation and build him a better organ, to which they agreed. From his hospital bed he said, I've got two penises, but no wife. I'm hoping when I get rid of one of the penises, I'll get her back.
What do you mean? He had two put on?
What side does he wear?
So he's had both. So he's had three then?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
This is probably the thing that happened with Hitler when he had one ball, but he had three at one point, didn't he? So he just got one of the other ball, gave his mum one, and got the other one.
Man grows penis on his arm. I mean, why people are constantly losing their penises around the world? I've no idea.
But why?
I didn't realise it was a bit.
What do you mean, why on the arm? It's just a graft, isn't it?
Yeah, but put it on like your buttock or your side. Not, you can't wear a short sleeve shirt. Why did they've done that before? I don't understand it. Why not just graft it onto the side of your leg or something where it's high up, close to where it should be?
I don't know. To get it used to the environment. Like when you were like released a duck into the wild.
I've never understood that. If there's a doctor, again, you know, we had a doctor last time, this is someone who can let us know why they put it on the arm.
So they can keep an eye on it, presumably. He's not going to work with this knob on his arm. He's probably in a hospital bed and under examination.
Right.
So what do you think? They pop the knob on the arm, say, come back in 3 weeks. What do you do, by the way? I'm a mechanic. Keep the knob, keep the long sleeve shirt, because supposed to go, why have you got a knob on your arm, mate? What are you talking about? He doesn't go back to normal as a teacher. Sir, what is it, Simpkins? You got a knob on your arm. No, don't worry about that. Do your maths. What do you think this bloke's walking around with a big knob coming out of his arm?
Why on the arm?
So they can keep an eye on it. So it's not.
But if he's in bed, just get him to not put any undies on or whatever, and just have a little sly look at how it's going. Even in hospital, if you're in a shared, like, little hospital room, people going, oh, I've had heart problems. What's your problem? He's there with his arm out.
Yeah, but I don't think it counts as a decent exposure when they're grafting a knob on your arm, sticking that out of the bed.
Imagine if he's driving, he's just got it out the window. People driving by.
Is that bloke giving me the finger?
Yeah, at the end of the man grows penis on his arm story, it says, a Moscow surgeon said the man will be able to have sex in a few months. He said, women will never suspect. What kind of a doctor talks like that?
Yeah.
I don't know, is this cock now, seriously. The birds will never know. He'll be able to go berserk.
Yeah.
They'll never realise he grew on his arm.
That is unbelievable. Would he have a little scar on his arm, do you think?
Yeah. I don't get it. Like I say, 83936 if there's a doctor out there.
Or indeed if you've ever grown
a tailor. Making you a shirt. What size do you wear your cock on to? My left arm.
That's a bit of stones.
Yeah, beautiful. Wear it on me. Wild Horses by the Rolling Stones on XFM 104.9. Well, I think the listening public would have enjoyed knob news there.
Oh.
So, there was a lot of knob news this week.
I was surprised. You know, I would have thought it would be hard sometimes to get knob news together, but
I would have thought it would have been part of a bigger news programme, but I mean, I don't think we'd dedicate a whole sort of, like John Craven's news round.
Yeah.
A whole 5 minutes to knob-related news.
Yeah.
There was other news, was there, in the week at all? It wasn't just all knob-related, you didn't just research.
No, they're the ones that sort of stand out. there was Christ on a crisp.
Right, what's that? That's obviously a crisp that someone vaguely thinks looks a bit like Robert Powell.
Yeah.
Yeah, what a load of twaddle, yeah.
There was a bloke who can, blow up balloons using his ears.
What do you mean?
Okay.
It's all connected, isn't it? That's, you know, you're just redirecting it, aren't you?
Pointless, isn't it?
It is pointless. No, I'm sort of downplaying it like it's no big deal, but it is pretty impressive.
It's not. When was the last time you blew up a balloon?
Oh, I don't know.
That's what I mean. It's not needed. It's not impressive. That's what I mean.
But you could say that about any form of sort of like bizarre entertainment. I don't think you have to hang yourself from hooks, but a lot of people go and see Jimmo Circus. I mean, I wouldn't. I don't see the.
But would you go and see that?
What, a man blowing up balloons? No. If it was a mate of mine, I'd go do that thing you can do. To a group of new friends, I'd go, all right, then I'd get on with it. You know, to me it's below an average card trick doing something like that.
Apparently though, he does make balloon animals with his penis, so
which is pretty good, isn't it?
Up with his ears, so
it's always a snake. It's not a snake. I go, yeah, well done.
Back to the balloons. Right, right. Now listen then. What about another feature we'd like doing?
What?
Song with a story.
Okay, he's been working on this, hasn't
he? Hasn't he?
He's like a producer, isn't he?
Yeah.
But with a completely round head.
Just, you know, I was saying that, you were saying I don't like music. but I'm saying I do if I can hear what they're singing about. And there's a reason to sort of listen
so is
to
it. Have you turned into 50s dad? What is this?
No, but you know, it's like, it's nice to have a song where you go, you know, I can't turn it off because I need to know how it ends. I mean, it's like a mini.
Right? Like a mini film. You can't sit through a film unless it's got a grotesque net. He can watch The Elephant Man because he's getting a glimpse of this. He's waiting to see the bloke's face. That's all he's waiting for. Right? And so 3 minutes is about as much as you can maintain his.
Well, last week we did Babushka.
Yeah.
You know, that woman dressing up, sort of tricking her husband, then it sort of backfires and that. Don't know how it ended properly. I don't know if we split up or whatever. But this week, this week.
There's no follow-up. Kate Bush isn't now penning the sequel.
Mm.
Right, go on, Enter. What's this leak?
Pinball Wizard.
Right, okay, what's the story there?
It's about this sort of deaf, dumb, blind kid.
Right.
Who's good at pinball. That's it.
So I don't believe he would be good at pinball.
But even if he is, it's a lot to give up, isn't it? Just for that.
Well, he didn't give it up.
No, but it's not like, well, you can't even say to him, oh, you know, a lot of bad news and that, but you're good at pinball. It's just a bit rubbish. I mean, does he even know he's playing pinball? Is what I'm saying. Do you know what I mean? And it's not hard, it's just moving the thing, you know, just hitting the buttons hard.
Yeah.
It's not like, you know, if he was good at Pac-Man or something, you go, oh, yeah. But
it wouldn't scan, would it? Well, I mean, what were they thinking of? What were the Who thinking of when they wrote this?
Well, let's have a listen to it.
But, you see, maybe he's a dark man wizard.
It kind of works.
Yeah. He's deaf, dumb and blind, though.
Yeah.
That's pretty grim, isn't it?
Rubbish, isn't it?
Well, don't say that. I think that's alright, I can't hear you.
No, but it's just the worst, isn't it? I can't imagine what that would be like. It's pointless. And being a tapeworm or something, isn't it? It's just. No, but what I'm saying is, what sort of a life is that? It's horrible.
It is a bit like being one of those creatures deep in the ocean.
Well, look, can I just answer your questions? It must be terrible.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, job done.
But would you want a song about it? And, you know, he's good at pin.
But it's not a real person, which, I mean, well, you were getting onto the realms of people's disability. But he is not a bloke that existed they sang a song about.
Well, listen to it. Anyway, that's.
It's not a true story. I don't need to listen to it.
Let's have a listen.
Oh. Okay. Pinball Wizard by The Who. A little song with a story there. And a little deaf, dumb and blind kid. Thoughts, Carl?
I just, it's depressing, like I say. I don't know why. Is he enjoying playing the game?
I don't know, let's get Pete Townsend on the phone.
Carl, what are you talking about?
I'm just trying
to listen to the lyrics, right? Deaf, dumb, blind kid, he can't hear, no bows and bells, he can't see any flashing lights, he plays by sense of smell. Now, I'm pretty sure that isn't a scientific document Pete Townsend is reading out there when he wrote this song. He's making it up.
But the thing is, with all songs or stories, there's got to be a little bit of realism to it. Well, do you know what I mean? Why bother putting money in it? Just let him hit the buttons if he's happy.
That's true.
That's a fair point.
That is a fair point. That is a fair point.
Yep.
That is great. Yeah, well, I think you've made Daltrey and Entwistle and the whole crew look fools.
Yeah, they won't get fooled again. Nice.
We're supposed to do it. I mean, of all the thing, I mean, it is horrible. We're not, like, having a go. This is what I always worry about when I play. But at the end of the day, that's what he's singing about, so we're not having a go.
No. But and he's not a real person. Doesn't really exist. I say again, it's a fictional person playing pinball and always getting a replay. Okay? This fella's saying that he's good at pinball. He's played from Sherwood to Brightwood, but this little deaf and blind kid, he can't believe it. He cannot believe it.
If you had to lose something, Steve, right?
We wouldn't need money.
That's true. <enough.
laughs> Your sight, or your ears. What?
That's too much. I can't decide. That's too painful. Sight or your ears?
What about you?
Intuitively, it would be your hearing, because I couldn't.
No, I think it's got to be sight for me.
Yeah.
Well, you're always together, so that's all right.
Anyway, listen, is it almost time?
Well, I've got to ask Carl. Sorry, I've got to ask Carl.
Oh, sorry, go on.
Carl, what would you rather be, deaf or blind? When did this question ever really come up? When is it, when the doctor goes, well listen, you've got our son, well we can operate, we can either lose your eyes or your ears, it's up for you. This is never a decision that has to be made by anyone ever in life. But go on then, would you rather be blind or deaf?
It depends where you live.
I'm not even sure these are PC terms, blind and deaf anymore. Would you rather use your sense of sight or sight of hearing?
Depends where you live.
What do you mean it depends where you live?
If you lived in, like, a barren sort of, you know, Africa or whatever.
Right.
Out to sea. Right.
Sure.
So, you could lose your sight.
Sure, but if you lived in a woman's locker room.
Well, if you lived in
quite noisy.
Yeah, it's quite noisy.
It's like, you stop banging that door.
Yeah, I'll have my sight.
But if you live in like New York, low to sea, but a little bit noisy.
Sure.
So
perfect.
That is a brilliant answer. Unbelievable. Once again, can we have monkey news? This show's like one long monkey news, isn't it? When you're tuning to hear Carl Pilkington.
No, I'll tell you what. Why don't we play a little short track?
Right, what was your short track?
What? What is it, Steve?
Green Day.
Green Day. We'll cram in the monkey news. We'll play the ads. Justin's here. That'll be that. Right,
go on.
That's what we'll do.
FM 104.9, which is HD Motion Carbon. So we need the answers quickly, Carl.
Rockbusters. We're running out of time. We've got Rockbusters and Monkey News to come in this fun-packed show.
Give us the clues, give us the answers.
Right, the first one was, why don't you borrow a little bit of land off Mr. Boardman, or Mr. Laurel, or Mr. Fletcher?
Go on in,
right, what am I getting at there? The initials were LS, right? Lease a Stan's field, right? Because you're borrowing it, that's leasing it. It's Stan Boardman, Stan Laurel, and, the field and that, isn't it? Second one. I'm gonna annoy those seabirds. That was B. What are you doing when you're annoying a bird? You're bugging it. What's a seabird? A gull. Buggle. Buggles. Right? Bug gulls.
I don't know where to start, mate.
Right, don't worry about it,
I don't know where to start. If we had more time,
don't worry,
I'd throw him out of a window. Yeah. Right.
What the Scouse fella said to the robber he found in his house next to his vineyard.
Go on.
That was AW.
Yeah.
That was A, me winehouse. Right? A, me winehouse.
What?
A, me winehouse.
What do you mean winehouse?
It's a vineyard, it was a cottage in a vineyard, so that's
what
I
was saying. How was the clue again?
A, me winehouse.
Yeah, but what do you mean? Why is it a robber?
Because the robber's getting in and he's sort of saying, hey.
But what's the robber got to do with it? Why is it just a normal bloke? I'm going to say, why is he saying, hey, me winehouse? Why is
because
he saying that?
He's saying to him, hey, get out, Cabby.
Well, no, I sorry, her name is A. Gowby Winehouse. Her name is A. Gowby Winehouse.
Gavin Thompson got him all right. He's in Edinburgh, so he's winning Ladder 49 and that's safe. That's on the
And he's going into the prize draw to win those. This better be a good monkey news, Carl. That's all I'm going to say. Because that was drivel. Amy Winehouse.
Play the jingle.
Oh, chimpanzee, that monkey news.
Right. There's this monkey, right?
Yeah.
And it had been, do you know you hear about monkeys being badly treated and stuff like that?
Yeah.
So, anyway, it goes into this home. It's 14, this monkey. It's called, Matty. Right? Goes into this home where it's looked after.
What do you mean home?
Just like, just a little monkey home, right?
Okay, so zoo.
Yeah, kind of, yeah, but they haven't got any other monkeys there, right?
What have they got there?
They've got just little animals and that, but not that many monkeys. But anyway, because he's there on his own, again, you know...
When you say monkey, do you mean a chimpanzee, by the way? Because you usually do.
Yeah.
I can't believe that journalist thought this was scripted.
Amazing.
So, anyway, yeah, so it gets sort of pally with the people working there and that, and, it's smoking fags, it's having a drink at night and all this, right?
What do you mean it's having a drink at night, huh?
It's all here, Steve. I mean, we haven't really got time, but...
Well, don't say it's all here like it's proof. You've got another stupid story that someone has put onto the internet. Someone sitting at home in their bedroom has put onto the internet.
So it's having a fag, it's drinking a lovely glass of Ben Rock Station.
The wine is perfect for a barbecue.
Yeah.
Anyway, it's loving life, it's forgetting about its past and everything, right? When this other monkey comes along.
Oh no. Trouble's brewing.
Go on.
Right. That comes in, something's said. Right, forget it then.
Forget it.
We're at a loss.
magic numbers, and the magic number is 104.9.
Oh.
XFM. I'm Ricky Gervais, with me, Steve Merchant and Carl Pilkington. Right, two more shows. Till we're off air for I don't know how long.
Is that two more including this one?
Yeah, no.
Two more after this.
It's right, this is one, and then there's another one.
Right, two
and
more
that's
shows.
The last one, there's two more shows, yeah.
Including
this one. We're starting now. If I just said this at the end, it might have been ambiguous, but I've said at the beginning, there's 2 hours, that's a whole show,
right.
So there's two more shows.
Two more shows including this one.
Yes, okay. Obviously.
So one more show after
It's only
one.
1:05.
After this show, one more.
Yeah, one more, yeah.
Next week there's one more show, that means two altogether.
Oh, no, it's only one more show. Good night.
Okay.
Now, it better be a good one, Carl. Have we got, Rockbusters?
Yeah.
To win those prizes? Check. Have we got Monkey News?
Check.
Is it a real Monkey News, or is it
always
something
is.
That's slightly made
always
up
is.
That you- What?
Always is. You should check.
Okay, Knob News?
Here we've got a bit of Knob News, yeah.
I'm worried that Knob News, because it's only about penises, is a little bit sexist. Have we got any fanny facts? can we sort that out for next week? I don't want to alienate our female audience.
Welcome to Minge London. good, I'm glad that's out. Well, brilliant. We've got a song with a story?
Yeah, doing that.
What is it?
I don't want to sort of tell you what it is yet. Because
right.
The song isn't that great. Do you know what I mean?
Good.
It's not a song that's like an XFM song, but every time I hear it on, say, like Magic or whatever,
yeah.
I have an argument.
105.4.
Yeah, I have an argument with Suzanne that, you know, what I think it's about, and she says, don't be stupid, it's not about that, and I'll say, no, it is.
And so we're going to decide who's right.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know what song you're talking about, and I don't know what the argument is, but Suzanne's right.
Definitely.
No doubt about it.
We'll have a listen, but I'm hoping that once people sort of listen to it again with my thoughts every time.
Well, this song sums up what people should think of you. It's don't believe a word. All right, that's the sort of links I'm capable of.
If that doesn't bag us for Sony, then nothing.
Thin Lizzy, don't believe a word on XFM 104.9. I'm gonna miss this show. It's been good.
You won't be the only one.
No, well, you know, so we'll come back again. We've got a lot to do over the next few months, but maybe for Christmas or just after. But I still call Carl every day anyway.
Oh, sure.
Today I called him a couple of days ago.
Of course you did.
And I went, it was the weekend, I went, what are you doing? He went, oh, just in Regent's Park and that. I went, what are you doing? He said, just going for, oh, Jesus. I went, what? He went, a caterpillar just fell out of the sky. I went, what? He went, a caterpillar just fell out of the sky. God, it's there, it's wriggling around. I went, I'm sure a bird didn't just drop it. He looked at me and went, oh yeah.
Of course he did.
Yeah.
For a moment he thought caterpillars were raining from the sky.
I thought I was in Chicken Licking.
Yeah.
Unbelievable. Why did you think a caterpillar had fallen out of the sky?
I don't know, it just startled me a bit.
I love Carl being startled!
I like the idea of him straight on the phone to Trevor McDonald. Look, Trevor, there's caterpillars, insects falling out of the sky. They're falling out of the sky now. Put it on the news, quick. Are you sure there wasn't a bird? Oh, there was a bird. Yeah, sorry, Trevor. Bye!
But it was weird. After, like, I hung up the phone and that from you, I sort of sat there for a bit watching it.
I imagine him cross-legged, just in front of it.
But do you know what?
Grass.
Because of his shape, the shape of his head, and his sort of IQ, I bet the caterpillar was thinking, mama.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's unbelievable. Go on.
It was sort of running about all over the place, right, Steve? So the caterpillars have loads of feet and that, don't they?
Well, they have 6 legs. They're actually a larva of an insect. They have 6 legs, but they have little sucker things to hold on to the cabbages and that.
No, they've got more than that.
They've got, I'll tell you, they've got 6 true legs. Trust me, I'm a scientist.
And you were thinking what, Carl?
Well,
they've got little pods. They've got little pseudo pod legs and little suckers. Yeah.
But it was running about like everywhere, like mental, but sort of running off to the left, and then it sort of went back to where it was. Then back, you know, went right and what have you. And I'm just thinking, whoever gave them the legs, right, what's the point if they don't know where they're going on that? Do you know what I mean? If you can get about-
Imagine that sentence. Do you hear that? Did you hear that sentence? Can we play that sentence back?
No, I don't think we can.
Imagine who gave him that legs.
Whoever gave him them legs, what's the point if they don't know where they're going in
that? And that. Always and that.
And that, but maybe you just, to be fair to the caterpillar, with all its legs, okay, and you know where it was going, it had just been plucked from its house by a bird, shot up into the sky, and then dropped from 80 feet, hitting the ground.
Onto the head of a weird, bald-shaped monkey.
It was probably concussed.
Yeah. It's one of them things again, though.
But it still knew more about the world than you. How does that make you feel?
I just think it's a waste of time. I'm not on feet. It's the same thing as the,
Feet! Now it's got feet, yeah.
It has a nightmare buying shoes, doesn't it, Carl?
What was it you were saying about leeches and that? So we're talking about insects.
They're not insects.
What are they?
Well, I think they're probably, class, they're probably platy helminth. Probably sort of like a flatworm type thing.
That's what you were thinking, was it, Carl?
Yeah, I'm not sure about that. I don't know what the phylum is, but there's no. They'd be. Yeah.
What was the leech? What was an interesting?
Well, there's an experiment where you get a maze for a leech, and there's a bit of blood thing, and it learns. It eventually finds its way to the blood, okay, and then it knows. Okay. And if you put it back to where it starts, it knows where it's straight. It goes straight towards it because it's learnt it. If you liquidise that leech,
right,
and feed it to some leeches who have never done the maze, because of a thing called chemical memory, they find their way straight to the blood.
That is extraordinary.
It's extraordinary.
Yeah.
I mean, it's incredible.
We should try that at Hampton Court one weekend. But maybe with some tourists. We'll just blend up some tourists.
Or the people on them, I tell you, we would do it. Those people who go on Celebrity Love Island.
Any of them.
They would do anything to get them. They would be liquidised. People have enemas. They would do they wank off pigs. They would do anything to get on telly. What about that? Be liquidised and fed to another. Get one D-celebrity slapper, liquidise her and feed her to another slut.
So he blends
and see if she can find her way. And see if she can find her way to Channel 5.
Yeah.
What a brilliant show, hosted by Jimmy Carr.
Of course.
That'd be amazing.
The Kinks, Better Things on XFM 104.9. Steve Merchant, Ricky Gervais, Carl Pilkington.
But do you know this, we were talking about the leech thing.
Sure.
Right. You're saying, put them in a blender.
I'm not saying that.
Well, someone did.
Yeah.
Why were they doing that in the first place? Do you know what I mean? How did they find out that if you put leeches in a blender?
I don't know, they probably kept notes. I don't know.
But what made them, were they just having a laugh? What made them go?
Was it a party?
It was a couple of research scientists. They'd been given £1 million and the boss was coming around to say, what are you doing? And they were just making a smoothie and they went, quick! Mr. Yakamoto's come round throwing some leeches! What are you doing?
Just feeding these leeches to some other leeches. All right, well that looks like science. I'm off.
Here's another £1 million next year.
That's how they work, though, isn't it? A lot of these scientists.
That's exactly how they work.
I'm just saying they're getting away with murder.
Go on.
Well, just the way they do sort of spend.
And you can't say anything in front of him because everything's got a point with him. Mm. You can't have a conversation with Carl because he always puts in a curveball. You tell him something. And the question comes back that you never could have expected. When I told him about that story about the monkey who'd run away because he had an argument with his father, he said, what was it about? No one in the world thinks that. No one in the world would ask that question.
The leech thing. Do you know how you said, show the leech the way to its bit of food, whatever it's eating or whatever, in the maze, right?
Yeah.
It makes its way, right? It eats the cheese or whatever.
Blood,
right? And then you give it
everything's a cartoon with Carl as well, isn't it? Everything is a cartoon.
It's a leech with a little hat and a little baby bell at one end.
But what happens if you got another one and move the bit of blood?
Yeah.
Right? So feed those two leeches to one. Then what? So is it going to get confused or do you know what I mean? Which way will it go if it's eaten two leeches?
Yeah.
That have done two different ways.
Yeah.
Is it sort of stressed out?
No! I don't know. It probably knows both routes. It probably goes, well, there's one over here. Oh, there's one over here as well. I'm happy, I've had two for the price of one.
Right,
and
okay.
I'm full of bleaches.
What's the best that can happen for like...
I don't, what are you talking about? What do you want
because
out of
I'm
me?
Because I'm just saying if they could, if by that, if by doing that they can go, right, we can do this, we're humans.
I'd go, oh, what do you mean? What do you mean in the name of Christ? What do you mean?
All I'm saying is, what's the point in doing it?
Think, what do you mean?
If you could do it with humans, I'd say-
But what, right, Carl, think about what you're saying, man.
Yeah, I'm saying-
If you could do it with humans, do what with humans?
Say if Einstein, right, didn't do all that maths that he did, right? Say if he got to E equals and then he died. Squash his brain, give it to someone else, say, right, eat that. And they go, right, it's E equals N2 squared, isn't it? What I'm saying is-
But they wouldn't, they'd go E equals, oh. Wouldn't they? If it was chemical memory, they'd go, oh, E equals, oh, yeah, same as Einstein said. Yeah, I just ate his brain. What am I saying? What are you, what have you made? Carl, think what you're saying. It's unbelievable. The thing is, right, you, actually, you are what a scientist does. You just keep saying why, and what, and why, and what. But nothing's ever enough for you, which is good. It's nice to have an insatiable...
I get annoyed with all the amount of time and effort that's put into stuff that's useless. What's the next stage to squashing that leech? If it's not going anywhere, forget it, work on something else. It's the same way in some science magazine I was reading about... Is there anything smaller than a quantum electron or something?
Yeah.
It's like, if it's not getting in the way, don't worry about it. Why are they worrying about things we can't see?
If you blended up Carl's brain and fed it to someone, would it make any difference?
No, they wouldn't even notice, would they? You fed it to a leech, and the leech would go, oh, I don't know what I was doing. I don't know what. Where was I going?
I'm even more confused.
I don't know. Talking of leeches, did you see the dregs that they put into Big Brother last night?
I've not been watching it.
It's bad enough anyway. It's a house full of people you wouldn't cross the road to save,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
But. There's three, they've put in three more to spice it up a little bit. They've put in a low esteem model.
Sure.
Right? They've put in Mr. Bean, who is the whitest man I've ever seen.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's like a new race.
Yeah.
He's an easy through. And this thing that looks like Matt Lucas in a bikini.
Wow.
Unbelievable. The fat things on her back, I thought she was coming towards me.
Really?
It was unbelievable. And the first thing she said, she went in, she looked in the mirror, adjusted herself and went, oh, me minge!
Oh.
That's the level. It's un...
Do these people have relatives? Do they have... Is there anyone in the world who knows them, claims to be a friend of theirs?
Family. Families.
Do they have family there, or the family just... No, and they just moved away?
No. They're probably... Their family are probably quite proud of them. Because they're on the telly. Ugh. It's probably like, saw your daughter last night saying, all we minge on the telly. Yes, she was on the telly, wasn't she? Yes, she was on the telly. What about the bit about all we minge? She got one out immediately, went, got it out, lobbed it out. It's unbelievable. It looks like an experiment.
I can't watch it anymore. It's just too much now. Because I can't relate to those people in the like in the first series. I always remember it seemed like a genuine social experiment.
Yeah, exactly.
There was intrigue. There was drama.
Yeah.
It was genuinely great hypnotic television.
Now it's like putting ants in a jar and shaking.
I don't know what's. But even that, I couldn't watch that once a night every week.
No, I know.
It's just.
It is unspeakable that what people are willing to do now and the time because they've just put in people. I mean, it's unbelievable. It really is. You don't care about anyone. But I suppose what's good is that I think you watch it now because you want one of them to fall over and hurt themselves.
Yeah, or just choke on a chicken bone. And no one else in the house knows the Heimlich manoeuvre.
That's a good idea, isn't it?
Yeah, feed him more chicken. Send him more roast chicken. So we've got a wonderful celebration for you.
Senses by Feeder on XFM. Ricky Gervais, Steve Merchant, Carl Pilkington.
Right.
All right. How are you doing, Carl?
Yeah.
Another holiday?
Well, it wasn't holiday.
What was it? You had 5 days off work. Why isn't it holiday? You had 5 days not working for a living. You know how many days holiday gets a year now? 29.
Oh, that's more than teachers, isn't it?
It makes me sick. It makes me sick.
Well, I know the kind of hours you work, Rick. It's mad. I mean, if you're not in work by midday, you're furious.
No, but I mean, I'm always...
29's normal. For the normal working person.
Yeah, but, you know...
And anyway, it wasn't a proper holiday. I went to see my mum and dad. It's nice to see them and everything, but it's not holiday, is it?
Why?
It's not going away. It's not getting on a plane, is it? Going away.
Oh, is that definitely a holiday? What happened before 1950?
I don't know.
Who used to go... Who used to go to Blackpool, Brighton. That was holiday.
Yeah, but I didn't
Where did
go
you
to,
go?
Went to Wales.
There you go. Lovely holiday. Lovely holiday. Have a holiday in Wales. That's what they say, innit? Come to Wales and have a holiday. That's what they say, innit? Don't so, come to Wales and meet your parents. Come to Wales and have a lovely holiday.
Mm. Well, anyway, it was good and that. It's always good to see him.
Yeah.
But,
week off work.
Do you know, like, my mum likes gnomes and stuff?
Yeah.
Right,
of course she does. She's lived with one for 30 years.
She said, you know, get your dad to take us to this park where they've got, like, you know, 6-foot gnomes and stuff, right? Have a walk about.
That sounds like a nightmare. Yeah. Sounds like a living nightmare.
Keep an eye on Carl.
So anyway.
He stood still for 2 minutes, someone bought him.
No, you can't buy him and that. It's like a little exhibition thing,
yeah.
Right? And it's part of a hall. Right, this big hall that you have to pay to get in, but we didn't want to see the hall, I just wanted to see the gnomes.
Of course you did, yeah.
So, anyway, my dad says, yeah, well, we can get in there for free.
Of course he did, clever.
Right? So, we parked up on this little country lane, right? No one about.
How much did it go in? Like £2?
About £3 each.
Yeah.
But he said, well, yeah, but if you don't have to pay, do you know what I mean? You enjoy it even more, don't you, when you're walking about and you're thinking, I've got this £3 in my pocket, no one's having it.
Yeah. Right. No, looking over, sorry, for a bloke with a peak hat saying, can I see your ticket, please? I wouldn't enjoy it more, no. Go on.
Yeah, but you don't worry about it.
You've got a bit of money now, then, Rick.
Yeah.
You know, you've changed.
So, anyway, yeah. So we had to walk across about 4 fields.
For £3!
Right. And what happened was, we're walking through all these fields and what have you, big grass and muddy bits and all that, cause it'd been raining, and climbing over fences and stuff. And we're in this field, right, and I look to my right, and there's about 30 cows all staring at us, right? And Suzanne started to panic a bit. She said, this isn't, we shouldn't be here. My dad says, of course we can, we're allowed to go wherever we want, you know, all this land, it's, you know, it's rambler's rights and all that stuff.
Yeah. And take a cow if you want,
so,
unattended.
So
it's right for leaving him in a field unattended. I'm having one.
Yeah.
So keep us fed for a week.
Anyway, these cows start surrounding us.
Surrounding us? Brilliant!
Oh no.
Thanks, Tom.
And Suzanne's panicking, going, this isn't right. He's gonna, we're not gonna make it to the fence in time. They're moving faster than us, and he started sort of running a bit.
Wow.
And,
it's like some kind of bovine West Side Story.
Don't.
A gang of cows coming at you.
Don't worry about it and stuff. But, my dad had to sort of stand there and, like, wave a stick at him.
Of course.
And we got away, but Suzanne was, like, having a bit of a sweat on.
Got away.
Saying, you know, we could have got killed.
Sure.
And my dad saying, nah, it never happens. And I just wondered if it does, if there's a risk of...
Yeah, but it is rare, but, there's been a couple of cases of... being trampled by cows. They're not aggressive, they sort of run through you. Well, they're aggressive if they've got a calf. What?
You have kids with them.
Kids, yeah. That's a goat sort of thing. Yeah.
Maybe they were trying to sneak into the gnome thing, and they were worried that, like, if too many people did it, and they bought some cows, we can just sneak in. No one's expecting cows.
And the cows walk upright like you're a human. Walk upright.
They thought you'd blow their cover.
Yeah. Yeah, people have been killed by cows before.
That was like the highlight, and then,
so when you arrived there, you were presumably covered in mud, looking like something that had just come from Glastonbury, staggering around this exhibition.
It wasn't that bad, it was just like a woods, and it had like a funny sort of funeral, like a graveyard thing.
Right.
Yeah. With bodies sort of hanging out the ground and that, and, these 6-foot gnomes. And then we just set off again, walked back.
But you sure this wasn't a dream?
No, it was good. But then I got back, right, Steve, and called up Ricky and said, right, you know, are you about? Have a chat and that. So he said, oh, just come round, it's a nice day. Have a drink and what have you. So I got round there at about 6:30, right? Go up to his door, knock on his door, right? He stood there with his tackle out.
Yeah, what did you make of that? What was wrong with that?
happened to you? What's wrong with
that? Why are you looking at it?
I try not to look at it. But again, you're always sort of attracted to it, aren't you? Kind of like...
I've never been attracted to another man's tackle. I don't know what you mean.
You can't help but have a little sly look. And especially when it's there. When you ring the bell, and I mean the one on the door, right? And that's hanging out.
And does he dress to the left or the right?
It was to the left, wasn't
it? Yeah, it was left, yeah. Just popped out of the shorts. For him. Just popped him out of the shorts.
Should have seen the state of him. Shorts on, no top, cigar. Looked like someone out of The Sopranos. It was a mess.
We sat on the balcony drinking wine, didn't we?
Did you pop it back in, or was it
straight? Yeah, I popped it straight back in. I've got the laugh.
Sure.
I've got the laugh I wanted.
Yeah.
He walked in, he went, it's not that hot. Straight away, it's not that hot. Oh, brilliant. Was that knob news, or was there more?
No, it's got more knob news.
That's just a taster.
Just a taster.
Listen, let's play some average. Let's play some great music, and maybe we should have some early knob news.
Early knob news coming up.
Once this big dog chased me.
Landed by Ben Folds on XFM. I'm Ricky Gervais, Steve Merchant, Carl Pilkington.
We've had a couple of emails, Rick, saying that there have been reports of people actually being killed by caves.
Yeah.
So it is actually quite a lucky escape for Carl and his family.
The worrying thing about that is it's tragic, and anyone dying unexpectedly, it's terrible. But what makes it worse is when it's something like being killed by cows, because there's a slight... I mean, a slight humour aspect.
Yeah.
Are you killed by a cow?
Yeah.
You know, like for example, if you were killed by a falling safe.
Yeah.
The vicar might laugh.
Yes.
That's my worry.
Yeah. Well, I read a story in the paper of a man who fell out of a window and died. He fell out of like, he was like a third story window and he fell out. But it was slightly amusing because at the time he was mooning.
I know.
For a laugh, he was mooning someone and he fell out.
I know.
So when he fell, like, even though it was tragic, he obviously had his trousers around his ankles and his arse out.
I know, the thing, there was a kid who died, got hit by a truck mooning. But you know, the worst thing about that is, it's not funny enough to be killed for.
No.
Mooning isn't funny enough.
No, it's just not a good enough gag.
Do you know what I mean? It's a witless sort of thing to do, and then to be killed for it.
If you've just done a 2-hour impromptu Eddie Izzard style, you know, routine, and then you got tragically killed, that would sort of make sense.
But doing something that's
it's almost karmic, because it's such a bad joke.
Yeah,
it's
exactly.
It's like some weird universal karmic where it's like, if you hadn't been mooning, maybe you wouldn't have got killed.
I know.
If you haven't done such a lame joke, maybe you'd be okay.
Yeah, but that's it.
You don't want to be walking along, you know, you want to be walking through the garden and stand on a rake and it flips up.
And it hits you so hard.
And it's like a boing noise, is it?
Yeah, and it hits you so hard that it kills you.
It kills you, yeah.
That,
or you fall out of a window and a cactus goes up your bum.
Killed by a cactus up the arse. You're at a concert and a fat woman starts dives.
Yeah.
And she just squashes you. How did he die? He was squashed by a big hefty.
Mama Cass just jumped on him.
Just big fat woman squashed him to death.
Yeah.
Tell you what. Tell you what though. Right. Talking about fat, mate.
Go on.
I'm not having a go. But have you seen Michelle McManus on
You are what you eat. What has she eaten? Girls allowed. Winking out. It was unbelievable.
No, but to be fair, you know, she did.
Is she in a bikini one?
Yeah, well yes, but she was always a little bit.
Yeah, but just a little bit.
Well, no, she eats too much, right? But what I did like about it was that she had a go, you know? She did lose her...
hard than that, yeah.
Huh?
I quite liked her at the end of it, really.
Yeah,
she's not an unpleasant woman. She's a lovely woman. But, I mean, like I said before, there was that interview in Heat magazine where she... You know, I tend to eat 11 packets of Doritos a night.
Yeah.
11 I mean...
Yeah.
Come on, Michelle. Yeah.
That's too much, isn't it?
Unless you're trying to win some kind of competition, like trying to find some kind of, you know, a golden ticket in one of the packets, there's no excuse.
What could you possibly be trying to win to eat those every day?
But it wasn't her who annoys me, it's that doctor in it, that woman, she does me head in.
Yeah.
Can't be doing with her the way,
Well, she's not actually officially a doctor, is she?
No, and her bedside manner's not very good either.
No,
it's like the fear tactic that I think you want a little bit of...
And what does she look like? I mean, she doesn't look like the sort of peak of health. She's got that weird sort of witch-like crone face.
Well, it can't be good for you hanging about all that poo all the time. She's always delving into that every other day. I used to be told, you know, don't mess about with dog poo because it can make you go blind.
Yeah.
It's constantly at it.
Yeah, I know, yeah.
Rubbishing through it. And it annoys me the way it's like, you know, well, let's have a look at your poo. Let's see if you're eating the wrong types of food. The person's about 33 stone.
Yeah.
It's obvious.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Don't need to look at that. It just rewind, and I'll tell you the thing that, I mean, I'd never have it done anyway, right? But the colonic thing.
Did Michelle have that? I didn't see it.
Yeah, she had that done. And they're showing it, she sat there, sort of lying down. She's like, oh. But I don't understand why people have that done anyway, unless you are sort of bunged up.
Yeah, or you've got a cactus up there.
Or,
yeah.
But the other thing is, like, the way, like it's a clear tube. Why do you need to, you know what I mean? Why do you need to see what's whizzing past? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like some sort of generation game. You've got to remember what's going past.
You've got to remember everything, then you win a prize.
Why can't they just look at it in the bucket after and go, right, yeah.
Well, why look at it at all? Why do you need to look at it?
Well, it's...
out of interest, isn't it?
See what's come out.
That's where that went. Oh, that's what I've been looking for, that remote control.
How does it work? I don't want to go into graphic detail, but they just send water out there, don't they?
No, caffeine.
Caffeine?
Yeah, so it's like a big... It's like a gallon of coffee.
Wow.
That goes up there. And it wants to come out immediately, obviously. And then it percolates.
But when did that happen? How did someone sort of go, tell you what you want to do?
I think it was first invented on distraction to win a car. I don't know, do I? I suppose they thought there's stuff up there that's not coming out. It's for, you know, they find things up there.
Though, isn't it?
They did that thing that they find things up there that they swallowed when they were five and that, don't they?
Lego bricks and stuff.
Exactly, marbles. But I mean, meats and things can stay in there for, you know, it gets caught in a little, you know, a little recess in your 30 foot of tubing, and it doesn't come out.
Talking of meats, I saw an advert on the way in today. Question to both of you: who eats pepperoni?
I don't know.
Have you ever eaten a pepperoni?
It's disgusting.
I've never seen anyone eating a pepperoni. Buying one, I've never heard anyone say delicious pepperoni earlier. I don't associate it.
But I know. But
with anyone, I've never seen anyone.
When you think what is it, just sort of like. Curdled, salty. It's sort of like, do you want to try a big long blood bogey?
Yeah.
I won't, no. It lasts forever. Oh, that's scary then.
Yeah.
You just keep it. Keep it under your couch. It'll be just as nice in a year's time.
It does look like something you'd find down the back of the oven when you were cleaning out. One of those Gordon Ramsay documentaries.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Because I always associate it's pepperonis and it's the those nutrition drinks which are like it looks like a dog food tin. I think it's just called something like nutrition or nutri drink or something.
Oh, yeah.
And you always see some empty ones on a brick wall near a council estate.
Oh right.
Which I think the only people who eat them are homeless people.
I thought you were saying it's bodybuilders.
No, it's because you buy these. You can see them in regular news agents. It's not a bodybuilder.
I don't believe a homeless who's just got a quid from the guy who runs in and buys an isotonic.
It's not isotonic. No, it's basically if you don't want to eat a meal because you're too high on smack, it'll give you as much as you can possibly need just to keep you alive until your next.
And tell me, Steve, does the special brew do that? Or am I barking up the wrong tree with that?
I don't know.
Because they seem to be getting a lot of nutrition from special brew.
The people who make special brew now, they've just resigned to the fact that it's only homeless people who are drinking it. It's like, well, we may as well just market it chiefly at them.
What's the advertising? Takes the edge off when you can't find smack.
Yeah. Are you trying to sleep on Tottenham Court Road?
Oh, God!
New Order, World, XFM 104.9 with Gervais, Steve Merchant, Carl Pilkington, and it's Knob News time. We're all very excited. Now, last week's Knob News was what, Carl? Do you remember it was a man...
Who grew a knob on his arm?
Sure.
No, he didn't grow it there, did he? They put it there.
Well, I know that, but, yeah.
Just popped it on his arm.
Yeah.
Just a recap
of the week's news. Right now it's the headlines.
Well, we talked about it before. Do you know the little mouse that had an ear on its back?
Yeah, sure.
Right. Well, he thought he had a bad time, right? Listen to this one. Mouse walking about, but there's sort of wearing a monkey's testicle. They're just having a laugh. This is what I mean about a lot of scientists. What are they doing? When's that going to come in handy?
I don't know what you mean.
Well, they were seeing if, you know, say if a fella loses one, right?
Yeah.
Hitler or whatever. And they go, well, don't worry about it. We can sort you out. I don't know what the monkey's going to do, Not if they keep passing them on or whatever. But the actual monkey testicle was put on the mouse. And it worked. It worked for the mouse.
But isn't it, I mean, isn't a monkey's testicle quite large in relation to a mouse? Would it not look like the mouse was on a space hopper or something?
Oh yeah, it didn't look good.
Well, right, they didn't put it where its testicles would be.
No, they did.
But they put it, well, how could it walk then? The ear was on his back, so he could just get about.
Well, I don't know, but
well, you don't know, do you? You just guessed. Did they grow the monkey's testicles where the mouse testicles
would- Well, they look stupid anywhere else, though, wouldn't it?
Oh, whereas a mouse with monkey testicles, that's fine. Oh,
you'd be showing off. You'd be alright. I'd prefer that than the ear.
When that mouse gets put back in with the other mice, do the other mice go, George, you look different. Have you had anything done?
But the weird thing is, as well, apparently it still works as a monkey.
What? So, like, what are you talking about?
Like the, you know, the sperm and that was, it was still sort of monkey.
Of course
sperm.
It was. What are you talking about?
Well, that's weird.
But what? Carl, what? But what do you? It's only a thing to give it nutrients. That's all the thing they're testing. It's like grafting at that level. Right. What's your question? Because I'm right. What do you think? It would change eventually. It would have changed into a mouse testicle because it had been hanging round a mouse for so long.
No, I thought the actual sperm of it though would be a mouse's.
Why?
Because it's hanging off a mouse.
No, but your sperm is actually created in the testicles.
So
that's why it has to be outside your body. Otherwise, we put them in a nice little cage.
I'm guessing then that they've done this operation so that they can do it to humans. Why would I want a monkey testicle if my kids are going to be monkeys? What use is it?
No, think. That's no.
That's what happened anyway, Carl.
Yeah, but think. Think of what you're saying. They've grown a monkey testicle on a mouse to see if it would still function as a monkey's testicle, okay? So they can do that to humans. So think, Carl, what they'd do is they'd grow a human testicle on a mouse and it could still be used as a human testicle.
So what?
To give you a testicle that you've lost.
From a mouse?
No, from another person who it was kept alive on a mouse. Because it's kept the nutrients alive, as opposed to keeping it a deep freeze. Maybe bollocks go off after a week. I don't know. Maybe they get accidents. He had a little a card. Do you donate your testicles yet? I'll tell you what. No one needs testicles yet. Let's keep them on a mouse. You have yours ripped off in some sort of bizarre skiing accident. You go, well, you go in a Battersea dog town. You pick the ones you want. They can grow them on anything. They can grow them on a dash. Bulldogs are growing them usually. That's where you see a bulldog. Usually that's waiting for an operate. What don't you understand, Carl?
Hang on a minute. I thought this was knob news. Not well, testicle time. I don't understand why.
Yeah, this testicle time's not for another 10 minutes.
Yeah.
No, it's all sort of it linked and that though, isn't it?
Well, sometimes it's linked to a mouse.
But do you, I mean, what do you think about, like, I don't know, testing stuff out like that? Is it worth it? Could you not just go straight from...
But listen, Carl, I'm getting this information from you.
No, it's
if this
it's
was
right.
on Question Time and someone said, you know, Dimbleby and Paxman or whatever said it, I'd think about it as a moral dilemma. You've just said you saw a mouse with a monkey testicle. What do you think of that? I don't think any of it. I don't think anything of it is the answer, Carl, because I can't trust the info. I cannot trust anything that comes out of your mouth.
Well, it's true, but it's just all this, it's the same thing, innit? It's the leeches in a blender, it's the fella looking at an electron.
Yeah.
It's the mouse with an ear on its back.
Yeah.
I don't know what the point is.
But you don't read on. Because I've seen you read some, and you're going, look at that, man survives on eating knee. And I go, what else? You go, I didn't read on.
You look at the mouse with the ear on the back, and you just think, that must be murder at a concert. You don't think anything else. Is it worth sort of wasting?
You think he swallowed someone's ear? He gnawed it away and swallowed it, and it's just in his system.
Yeah.
No, I just get a bit sad about the mice. And
I agree. I mean, that is sad. Yeah. Of course, anything like that is awful.
But saying that, I remember ages ago they have a load of people on Oxford Street. Don't know if you've seen them where they get you to sign stuff.
Yeah.
And the woman got annoyed with me, right, because she was saying about, you know, drugs with animals, testing them out and stuff like that, which is bad.
Yeah.
And I was saying, yeah, it's really bad, and I was looking at the pictures and that. But I said, what would happen, you know, if like, the drugs, aspirin, and the monkey's got headache, is it such a bad thing? She got annoyed. Didn't want to listen anymore. It's a good point though, isn't it? At what point is it cruel to test stuff out and things?
Yeah.
Give it some Nurofen. It's happy.
Yeah, well, I bet that ear, I bet that mouse had, headache. Because everything must have been loud. The other, just did the other mice squeaking, must have done its head in.
Yeah.
Oh, that would give
him
a Nurofen.
Turn that radio down.
Give him a Nurofen, please.
Well, listen, are we going to get, Rockbuster out of the way quickly?
Go on then, let's quickly. Do
it. Give us a clue. It's not going to take long, is it?
Go on.
Right then. So, three clues and that. Initials of a band and artist.
Yeah.
You can win some stuff. Steve can go through the
Ladder 49 better be in there.
Oh, let me
just quickly,
it's Ladder 49.
You get on with those clues and I'll tell you what's happening.
And this is the last time. The winner of this...
No, we'll do it again next week.
Oh, is it? And then there'll be six people and we just draw someone out of a hat to win the signed Homer, the, Nigel Tufnell, and the Us as Flannels.
Right, you ready then?
But they've got great prizes. They've got Alias, they've got...
They have. They've got Alias, they've got The Aviator, a Batman cartoon series, M. Night Shyamalan's The Village, atrocious film, and Ladder 49, there it is.
Brilliant, isn't there?
Joaquin Phoenix, John Travolta. Their greatest challenge lies in rescuing one of their own.
Brilliant. Right. Go on, Carl.
Right, the first one then. When I'm ill, I throw up horse food. When I'm ill, I throw up horse food. How can that work? What's going on there? The initials there. I-H, right? It's a band or an artist or singer, something like that. I-H, they're the initials, the clue.
I've got it.
When I'm ill, I throw up horse food, right?
I've got it.
Right then, well, don't say anything. Works, doesn't it?
No.
Second one, that garden tool, it's not yours, what are you doing with it? Right?
Yeah.
That garden tool you're messing about with there, it's not yours.
Yeah.
Give it back.
What is it?
N-D. N-D. Right. Artist or a band. What's going on there, right? Third one. That male sheep sounds fed up. Why is he fed up? Right. T-R. T-R's the initials. That male sheep sounds fed up. What's going on? If you know the answers to them three, email in, ricky.gervais@xfm.co.uk, or you can text in 83XFM. Right?
Great prizes. You can win yourself a copy of Ladder 49.
Foo Fighters, Best of You on XFM 24.9. All right, Carl, you calm down now about science.
I'm just, it just does me head in a lot of this stuff. I think I would have been better off sort of growing up in the 1940s or something.
Why?
Well, there isn't as much science going on. People just live, don't they, for the moment.
So you'd, well, what if you'd had to go to war?
What?
What?
All right, maybe 1945, then I'd be happier. Just after the war. Just that bit after the war and before they start
messing
about.
What year would you want to be born?
When was the war over?
45.
Right. 46, then.
But there's people born 46. There's rationing for another 10 years.
56, then.
But there's a lot of science going on.
Oh, forget it. it just annoys me, all the messing about. They're always messing about with stuff, and I sometimes think, is it doing any good, is what I mean. Mouse with ears, mouse with monkey's testicles. They're messing about with a mammoth now.
Go on.
Well, they're just saying, well, they're managing to knock one together.
Who was?
And you just think, some scientist somewhere.
Andy.
No, but it's just, do we need, do you, I mean, we've done it before about the do we need them thing. The amount of creatures and insects and that are knocking about. You've got that caterpillar that I mentioned walking about, it doesn't know where it's going. Get rid of them. The mammoth. The world's busy enough. It's crowded. It's overcrowded now. How much room are they going to take up? Do you know what I mean?
Why are they doing it, Carl? Do you know? You've got, you just, all you know is that they're trying
because,
to muck around with
because they can, because that's all it is, isn't it? Because they can. You're messing about. Someone's being paid to do stuff.
What else are we here for? If not to try stuff out. What else are we here for?
What do you mean?
Well, what are we here for?
Just to enjoy life, isn't it?
Well, that's, some scientists enjoy knocking a mammoth together.
No, but don't worry about the mammoth. It died out, maybe it died out for a reason. Why didn't Noah say that if it was important.
Because Noah, what do you mean? Noah's not true, is it?
Well, I don't know. There might have been some truth in it.
What truth in it? That he put two of every animal that existed into an ark. How big was this then? Why didn't they eat each other?
Yeah, I know, I'm not saying-
Imagine the noise, Carl.
Yeah.
No, trying to get a bit of kit there.
There's points to that where I go, that didn't happen, because where could he have been where there was a hamster and an elephant and a, you know, a crocodile? Where was he? Do you know what I mean?
But none of it's true. What bit do you believe?
What do you mean?
It got a bit wet.
What are we talking about? The mammoth or the-
No. What is up with you?
No, it's just that we had
No, seriously, have you got brain damage?
No, it's just that we had a lot of topics going on there. I just don't know which were, you
No, we were
about.
Talking about Noah. And then you suddenly go, I know where we was, where did we what, the mammoth or Noah, what? What you did, none of it's true. What, think of it. Oh, God. Think of the first thing. Build an ark. Alright.
Can I just clarify, what's an ark?
It's a bit a big boat thing.
Right. Yeah. I've never had any experience of carpentry.
Just build a big boat thing.
But I'm not really.
Just have a go. Don't worry, you'll be all right. I'll make sure it's all right.
But once I've built that, I mean, how big should I build it? What am I?
Very big. It needs every animal. Go on. Every animal.
I mean, the boat building. Fair enough.
I told you to make it big.
Right.
Don't worry about the fish. They can swim.
Okay, but so
all the birds. Get the flightless ones though, they're drown. Get the flightless ones. They would not the penguins. They're flightless, but they can swim. But all other animals.
I should be writing this down.
why? I mean, wouldn't you have took that opportunity to go right? You know, forget the, you know, whatever. Mind you, the jellyfish didn't need to get in it, did it? But there's other animals where you can.
We don't need to be here.
No.
Because Carl is actually having a little argument with his own head. It's like, you remember that comic strip, The Numbskulls?
Yeah.
Where there's loads of people in there doing different stuff, that he can hear them.
Yeah.
And sometimes his own mind puts him off.
Yeah.
Like just then, he has an argument with himself and it puts him off. Right, what's your question?
I'm just saying, don't mess about with a mammoth.
Whoa!
Good.
Okay.
Well, what a platform! It's good. You know, we've got our radio show, we've got our own radio show. People are spending money to advertise it. People are actually bothering to listen. And you've the words of wisdom coming out of your mouth is don't mess around with a mammoth.
Brilliant.
Great.
No, but just going back to
you sound just like Bob Geldof.
Oh, I can't be bothered with this.
He's trying to say
what can't you bother with?
Just because I think I've got a good point.
What? Don't mess around with a mammoth?
That's not a point.
Don't put your daughter on the stage, Miss Ingrid. Well, what are you talking about?
It's just that I think there's too many animals knocking about. I mean, I know you love your cat and what have you. Waste of time, though. What do they do?
Well, they frighten you.
Well, yours is mental, though, isn't it?
He's sitting there, and the cat right behind him, and he's chatting.
Well, your cat is crazy. It does go for it. It loves. It's got claws, big old claws.
Of course they have. It's a cat.
Yeah, but most cats don't come leaping at your ghoulies every time you sit down with a lovely warm hot cup of tea.
Aren't they pointless, though, Steve?
Well, I've always had a problem with pets generally. Yeah,
but cats the most. I was saying to Ricky about, I don't know why, out of all the animals that Dick Whittington could have took with him on his journey.
Again! Yeah,
forget the cat. Forget it.
Okay, you've got to walk to London because the streets are paved with gold. You can take any animal. What do you take?
It wouldn't be a cat because it would keep wandering off. You do double the distance. Try to get it back. Come here. They don't listen to you. I can't be dealing with them.
You don't get enough affection back from a cat. A dog, it loves you, it can't get enough of you. But cats, they're very snooty.
Well, they're cool, aren't they, cats? They're cool and independent. I like dogs as well, I like all animals. What would you take with you?
What, if I was Dick Whittington?
Yeah.
And where's he walking from?
I don't know, wasn't it Bristol to London or something? I don't know. Again, it's a bit hazy. This isn't well documented.
But why is he taking a pet and not a mate who... I'm not interested. I try and learn and you don't help.
That's a track from the new Amy Mann album, The Forgotten Arm. It's called She Really Wants You. XFM 104.9, Ricky Gervais, Steve Merchant, Carl Pilkington.
Mm-hmm.
Brilliant. Talking about, sometimes being a waste of time. Yeah. You know, when you came round the other night, before you came around, I'm sitting there, just at the computer. It's a hot day, wasn't it? As you know, I was in my shorts. I was tucked in. I didn't get an out until you came round. Just my own business. Jane got some wax strips, and she went, oh, let me just do your back. I went, no. I haven't got a hairy back. I've got a couple of wispy hairs on my shoulders, probably about 20 either side. No, don't worry about. It's not like I look one of those people that's like a gorilla on the beach.
I assume your back looks a little bit like Carl's head.
Exactly, yeah. And she went, oh, let me just do this. I went, no, she put it on my back, and she ripped it off. I went, forget it. She went, I've got to do the other side now. I said, forget it. God, I let her do the other side. It's ridiculous. It's so painful. And I've hardly got any hairs on the back, right? So, it made me think of something that I'd heard about. There's a thing that you can do, and I don't know why, for people with really hairy backs and people who are hairy all over, okay, called back crack and sack. They do your back, and there's some people that do look like little monkeys?
Yeah.
Right? They do your back, they do your ass crack, and they do your balls.
Oh.
In that order.
Oh, that again! Always a question that doesn't matter.
No, it does, because what I'm saying is it done from the top all the way down?
It's not done in one! What do you think? This is huge 30-foot band-aid type thing that you're wrapped in and then pulled. It's done a little bit at a time, isn't it?
Right, well, again, it still matters which order. Because if it hurts your back, it's definitely going to hurt the sack. That's what I'm saying. I think... What is it called? Back...
Crack and sack.
Or sack, crack and back.
No, it's called back, crack... I don't know. It's probably a marketing person telling we've got to be in order.
You could probably choose which order you want, Nick.
It's back, crack and sack.
It should be sack. Sack, crack, back. Definitely. It should be sold like that.
Why?
Because like I say, if you're lying there, look, you've had half of your back done. If you went, oh, forget it, right, there is no way you're going to have the sack done. Is it?
No. I'm sorry, I wouldn't have the crack and sack done anyway.
I don't know why people
I'm not
going
to have a back done. It doesn't need doing.
Where are people going where they've got to worry about the condition of the sack? At what event do you go to and you go, I've got to look sharp. I've got to look the part today.
I don't know.
Not the sack done.
Nudists?
No, because they're about being natural and that, isn't it? Normally they are hairy, like that woman on holiday.
Yeah, the women are, the men aren't. No, I don't know.
Yeah, they all are sort of pretty hairy. They believe in just leaving the body as it is.
I think little gay fellas like that bit, don't they?
Why are you looking at me? I don't know.
I don't know! If you're a little gay fella, and you've had it done.
Yeah,
just text in. What's the text thing?
83XFM, just text in, you know, tell us what? I don't know. Is there any information that we're missing? Is it painful? I assume so.
Of course it is.
Why did you get it done? That's the question. Why did you get it done?
Yeah.
Why is it important to have a hairless arse? Touring breaks on XFM. Ricky Gervais, Steve Mitchell, Carl Pilkington. Carl, are we doing your story with the song?
Is that what you want to do?
Yeah.
Well,
excited about it.
Like last, what was it the other week? We did
Babushka.
Did Babushka.
Yeah. Pinball Wizard. You said if he's deaf, dumb, and blind, he doesn't even know he's playing pinball, which is.
I just said don't bother putting money in it. That's all I'm saying. Let him play pinball, but don't waste 20p or whatever. Good point. This week, right, do you know how I was saying-
It is a good point, actually.
It is a good point.
Again, though, it wasn't a documentary. It was what? Just- it's not- didn't really happen.
Yeah, well, do you know how I was saying sometimes I listen to song- I like a song to be obvious what it's saying. Pinball Wizard was a good song.
You need a song to be obvious.
In the ghetto, you know, as a kid growing up, and all that rough area, gets killed for nicking cars and messing with guns and that. Living in the city, growing up in New York, rough area, how you cope with it and that, right?
Mm.
But they've got to be as simple as that, otherwise I'm not that
I've got a brand new combine harvester, it's about that machine, it's brand new, it's brand new.
But, even though it's new, he's willing to lend it out to other people.
No, but what I mean is, if you start trying to be clever, the story's lost on you, innit?
Yeah.
Not necessarily me or Rick, but yeah, sure.
Go on, we know what you mean. Go on.
On primates, yeah.
Well, this song here, right, it's not an XFM song, and you'll probably hate the song, to be honest.
Go on, what is it?
What's the song?
Yeah.
It's Wonderful Tonight. Right. Eric Clapton.
Okay, it's alright.
It's a bit
sort of bluesy, sort of ballad from the Late 70s, yeah, it's alright.
But I'm always arguing with Suzanne, because every time I hear it, I'm getting different pictures in the head.
Yeah.
Of, like, what's going on, right?
Okay.
And I'm convinced it's about, like, this little cripple fellow in a wheelchair, right? And he's knocking about with his wife.
Mm. And we don't say cripple anymore, do we, Steve? Do we say cripple?
I don't think we've said that since,
70s?
I think it's the 70s when we stopped.
Alright. Mm. Little, just a little fellow in a wheelchair, then.
Okay.
And the story is all sort of, you know, how he's being pushed about by his
wife. No, that's not literally.
By his wife? She's wheeling him about, what do you mean?
He's wheeling him about, they go to a party, everyone sort of looks round and looks at him.
What makes you think that he's in a wheelchair? What's the clues? What's the words?
There's loads of little things. There's like, well, like I say, something about his wife walking around with me. And all that. Well, of course, she's just pushing him about.
But walking around. If someone said, "Oh, she was walking around with me," I'd think they were both walking around.
There's a few.
But that's not. Well, there must be another. There must be a reason why you suddenly thought that fella's in a wheelchair.
Right. Is my wife's walking around with me?
Put on your makeup. And I feel all right.
No, and she's always saying, "Do you feel all right?" And that she's always asking him how he is.
Yeah, but she's
just listen. Let me play, right? And try and picture the scene, right?
But now I'm only thinking of a little fella in a wheelchair.
And have a listen to it.
Oh.
And you know, just everything that's being said.
Okay.
Understand why I'm thinking what I'm thinking.
No, never.
Right, you ready?
Yeah. No clue yet, yeah.
He's just sat there watching, probably.
No. There's no
waiting to have his done. And then she asked
you, do I look alright? Yeah, no clue, okay.
No, just, that's alright.
Well, that's just a woman getting ready, and he's fine.
Yeah, he's
just
sat there. And
he's got, to me, he's got a great pair of legs.
Right, well, he's sat there in the wheelchair.
No, he's not in a wheelchair.
Listen. Go to a party. Right?
Yeah.
Everyone turns to see. Everybody looks at him.
No, her. Lady. He's saying she turns head.
Walking around with him.
Yeah, walking around with me. We're both walking around. And then she asks me,
do you feel alright? Are you alright?
Yeah, it's a nice thing to say. And I say yes, I feel
wonderful tonight. He's alright, huh?
Yeah, he is alright, because he's got a great pair of legs.
Right, he might not have any legs in that, but he's happy.
He has got legs.
Right.
He has got legs. I don't know why you think he's in a wheelchair.
There's no clue whatsoever. It seems to be based solely on, do you feel alright?
Yeah,
which he just only say that because they're together at a party. Maybe he doesn't know anyone else there. It's time to go
home now. I've got an aching leg. So he can't drive.
Because he's drunk, probably. Oh, he's had a great time. He's been dancing.
Puts him to bed.
Because he's drunk.
Well, is he though?
He's turned out the light.
His hands work.
Yeah, there's no clue.
But the thing is, that's what I'm picturing.
But that doesn't mean it happened. You picture people that are half man, half moth. It doesn't mean it's possible. Do you know what I mean, Carl? What you think is usually not true. Suzanne is totally right. There is no reason. I have never, ever thought that Eric Clapton was singing about a little fella in a wheelchair. And the one clue in that, there's two, isn't it? Are you all right? Oh, let me say that, little cripple. Right, and, so I'll give her the car keys. Oh, well, why's she driving? You've got any legs?
Pushing him around and that.
No, pushing him around.
So we'll do one more next week, then.
Okay.
Jack Johnson on XFM. Carl.
Right.
Yeah, we were talking briefly earlier about something that you'd been reading.
Well, it's just that you're always having a go at me saying, you know, you're never happy.
True.
You know, what cheers you up? What's the best thing that can happen for you and stuff like that, right?
Sorry, I have never said to you what's the best thing that can happen for you.
No, but
I'm
like
trying
Steve's,
to encourage you.
Steve's, oh yeah, and you have a bit. I've started reading more and doing more science stuff, even though some of it does me head in. Like I say, knowledge is almost annoying. Right, knowing about that mammoth is annoying.
Think of that being a quote. Yeah. Things like, if I have seen furthers crossed to the shoulder of giants, we will fight them on the beaches. E=mc². Knowledge is annoying.
Yeah,
that's an amazing one. Carl Pilkington, 2005.
No, but it can get you down, can't it? Knowing stuff that's going on.
Yeah, knowing stuff. But sometimes anyway. I don't want to stuff in my head. When I read a horrible story or someone tells me, I wish I didn't know it. Yeah.
Yeah, that's all I'm saying. But at the same time, there was something in the paper about things to do before you die. And it was just stuff that I sort of looked at. I thought, don't want to do that. Cross that off. Not bothering with that. At number one, you always know what's at number one. It's the same thing every time.
Swim with dolphins.
Yeah. Don't know why. Do you want to do that?
What's going on down there that it's so good? What do we not know about?
I mean, yeah, it'd be fun. I'd love to sort of encounter most animals, to be honest. I mean, there'd be a few animals on the top of the list. I'd rather hang out with a bunch of chimps.
I wonder if it's you're down there with dolphins and you're swimming with them and they click away, click, click, click.
And they tell you a secret.
You go into like they lead you into a cave, right? But down there, it's like being at like Rolling Stones house in the 1970s. It's
they're
like
smoking.
There's drink, there's women,
yeah,
there's
Mars
bars. There's like
they're eating tuna, they're loving tuna.
They're loving it, but they can speak, they go, all this clicking stuff, it's nonsense. We're in a wild time then, go berserk, go crazy, it's 24 hours of non-stop debauchery.
I think it's spiritual.
But never mention it to anyone else.
It's incredible because you know they're so intelligent and you know. Do you know about dolphins though, that how intelligent they are?
Well, people keep saying that, but what have they done? You know what I mean? Why? What has someone done that they've gone? They spoke. I've read a book by a dolphin or whatever. What have they done that makes them so bright? It's the same way they go. You know, they look after you, they save you, and that. There's got to be one bad'un in that bunch.
Of course they. Sorry, I wasn't suggesting they're all flipper. I'm not just there constantly going round the oceans trying to save people. Mm. I mean, they're intelligent, you know.
In what way?
What do you mean, in what way?
What do you mean?
Why do because
why
they
do
pass
people
tests?
Keep saying they're bright?
Because of the things they can achieve and learn.
Like
and,
what?
And, well, they can tell shapes, objects, colours. Mm. Sorry, Carl, I mean, they're no match for you. They're not as clever as you. They're way down the list that. But it's all relative, isn't it? For a non-human, they're doing okay. They're up there with chimps, you know.
So what do you want to do before you die? Anything? Any achievements you want to have?
Well, if I'm ill, I'd prefer to go to the doctors than to go with the dolphins.
Yeah.
Why are you suddenly ill? It's not, they don't, when they say things to do before you die, they don't literally mean the sort of, the day before.
They mean
you croak
that you want to experience life. You can do it over the next 20 years.
Is that
years.
What you thought you meant? Like, literally
is
the
that
24
what you
hours
meant?
Before
like
you
a
die.
Priest there going, give me the lift. What is it, Grandad? Dolphins! You know, no fit state, Grandad. Get me in the water. Get me down to Brighton. What do you think that list means?
Well, yeah, that, you know, before you die.
You're incredible, Carl.
Amazing.
You're all this time.
The things to do before you die.
That's why he doesn't want to do any of them.
Didn't you think it was a bit extraordinary that you had to swim with dolphins and visit Disneyland and climb Mount Kilimanjaro all in the same afternoon?
That's why I said to you, I would be in no mood for a dip.
That's incredible! Always a
new twist on things. Always a new twist on things.
But you say about travelling and that, you like travelling and stuff, but what? Why?
Because I've seen and experienced extraordinary things. You know, I went to Kenya once, I met a man who was a vigilante, he was cleaning up his neighbourhood because the police were too corrupt to do it, carried a sword, and, you know, he was extraordinary, just, he'd been attacked, but he didn't care, he fought them off, he was trying in this little slum area to try and instill some law and order, he had to arrest his brother-in-law once. It was a fascinating story, and he was an extraordinary man.
I went to Manchester, and I saw two lads with big heads and webbed feet looking at a house. There was a horse in the living room. I mean,
that's living.
Leave it then. Listen, I didn't realise it's like 7 minutes to, right?
Well, come on then.
Well, let's do Rockbusters.
Yeah, do Rockbusters. And you got Monkey News.
Well, we'll see if we've got time.
No, we've got to do Monkey News.
Right, listen though, Justin, if he's out in the office.
Oh, look, just quick, do the right, Rockbusters listen, answers then.
Have you got a winner?
No, I don't even know the answers,
we'll pick one. Alright then, the first one.
Oh,
right.
I just got the plastic cut.
The first one was, when I'm ill,
yeah,
I throw up horse food.
Right. Yeah.
That's the clue. The initials were IH.
I got this one.
And that
I must
was,
say, too.
That was I Sick Haze, because when you're ill, you're sick. What do horses eat? They eat I Sick Haze. I Sick Haze is the answer. You got that. Second one, that garden tool you've got, it's not yours. What are you doing with it?
Yeah.
Right? ND.
That was different.
That was what's a garden tool? A rake, right? If it's not yours, what have you done? You've nicked it. You've nicked Drake. You've nicked that rake, Nick Drake, Nick Rake, right? So that's ND. So you got that.
That's fine.
The third one, that male sheep sounds well fed up.
Go on.
What's up with it? That was TR.
Yeah.
That was that ram. Ram. It's a ram, that's a male sheep. It's fed up, it's moaning. Ram moans, Ramones, the Ramones. So they got that as well.
Let's give it to Jenny McKean from Isle of Wight, because she's got all three of those answers, and,
right, straight onto Monkey News.
No, let's play a record.
We've got to do Monkey News! It's only 5 minutes to go!
We've got time for a record and then some Monkey News, surely.
Oh.
Bit of X2C.
Oh. What?
Making plans for Nigel XTC. Okay, let's play the jingle.
Ooh, chimpanzee that, Monkey News.
Right, this happened in, Pittsburgh, right? There's a rock band, and, they've got this studio in Pittsburgh and what have you, and they're laying down tracks and stuff like that. And in the studio that they use, right, there's this, this monkey works there.
I love the way he throws that in. Like he throws that in, this monkey works there.
No, it's just got a little gig there. He sort of, it carries the equipment in, guitars.
He does. No, he doesn't.
He just sort of cleans up after the band.
No, he doesn't.
Emptying the ashtrays.
Doesn't happen.
That's the gig it's got. Anyway, right?
Gets women out of the crowd and they want to,
with one arm.
So anyway, right, so the band's in the studio, right, and one of the band members brings some A&R fella to the studio to have a listen to the latest track. Right?
Yeah.
So they hit play, and they're all there going, yeah, brilliant, this is good.
Oh, no.
Anyway, so the fella says, yeah, I like the track, I especially like the bass on it. Right,
right, because this is bullshit.
So,
this is rubbish.
So,
and they hadn't laid down a bass track?
So, this is, have you heard it?
So Carl, please don't do this to me.
So the A&R fella goes, and it's like, the band members are stood about, and you're going, that's good that he liked it. And I'm saying, yeah, but what's he on about with the bass?
No, this is rubbish. This is absolute rubbish. Where'd you get this from?
Please, because we never get to the end.
This is absolute nonsense.
So they played it back.
Yeah, right? And it's the chimp playing bass. Definitely not.
So they were like, that's weird, we haven't got a bassist. Anyway, so they go, well, whatever, right? So
we haven't got a bassist. Yeah.
So
they go, whatever, let's go.
Oh, forget it.
Mr. Ben Folds. We've landed on XFM 104.9. I can survey Steve Merchant and little Carl Pilkington and his magical little manky round baldy head. He was described as a wacky mank in one of the papers this week.
Really? Brilliant.
Well, remember we were talking about it last week about he came round to my house and I popped out my
by Mr. Johnson.
Sure.
To take a little look at.
And his two
that made
doors.
The papers. That made the papers.
Wow. What paper? It wasn't front page of the Times. It must have been like the Daily Star or something.
Just squeeze Live 8 on the second page.
Yeah, so Wacky Mank.
Wacky Mank, that's
Wacky
great.
Mank.
Wacky Mank. We had an email from someone who reckons they remember you from body popping round Salford way.
Yeah, Eccles Precinct apparently.
You know that
anyway. I wasn't doing it round there though.
Where was we?
I was around Stretford Arndale.
And what were you doing? What sort of body popping was it?
Just a bit of everything. Caterpillar. bit of moonwalking.
Do you have a little piece of line that you used to carry around?
Well, mates had that.
Right, you didn't
bother bears.
Were you any good? But you weren't breakdancing, right? You weren't spinning on your head and stuff. You were more body popping.
Well, I hope you weren't speaking on his head, because you know that can sort of do, it can give you little brain damage and things.
Well, it can give you brain damage. Also, it can wear your head down, and also it makes your head perfectly round.
Yes.
Because gravity is pulling on
it. If you keep on doing it, obviously it's going to wear your hair
out, yeah. So you become sort of like a...
Stupid.
Stupid, bald, and roundy headed.
Yeah.
So, I very much doubt that you did do any of that. Did you, Carl?
Didn't do any of that.
Wow.
So you're shooting off in a minute, aren't you?
Well, yes, because we were trying to make prophecy history, Carl.
Yeah.
People are making public history all over the place, they're putting on a wristband. And it seems to be working. Because I haven't been poor for ages.
I haven't been poor.
And Alex had a stop bullying.
Alex was wearing a stop bullying wristband, and as he himself said, he seems to have sorted that out.
You haven't been bullied for ages.
I haven't been bullied for years.
So wristbands work.
I saw one in a shop window the other day, which said, stop child abuse. And I bought one, obviously, because, a lot of people say, you know, does it make a difference, but it was only a quid, and I'd only spent it on kiddie porn. So, you know, I think I've made a little difference there, in a small way.
On a serious note, I like the idea you're a paedophile, and you're walking along the street in your Mac, right, you got a puppy in one hand, a bag of sweets in the other, and you see this wristband, and you go, oh, stop it. Oh, okay then.
Yeah, I've thought before, that's what I think.
Okay, fair enough. Yeah, well, I won't be doing that again.
Yeah, he was hanging around in Topshop for unsavory reasons. He saw them in there for only a quid.
Carl, we haven't got long, have we? We've got an hour and a half because we've got a shoot off. I've got to shoot off down to Live 8 and then introduce Rem. So we've got a lot to pack in. We got the Rockbusters, and then we give away. I just saw those. I'll finish your sentence in a minute.
I look forward to it.
I'm getting excited. Yeah. I'm getting excited. So we've got so much to pack in. Yeah. I haven't got time to finish all mine. So listen, right? Do you know the things we're giving away? The signed little Homer, the Nigel Tufnell thing, and the Flannimals, right? Looks brilliant. They've done a brilliant job, the people here at XFM. So take back all you were saying about them.
And also, we should say as well, you've still got a chance to win that, because if you get today's Rockbusters, you go straight into the hat in a big draw, so you've still got a chance to win all those top prizes.
Play a record.
Put the monkeys.
Yeah. Monkeys. Pleasant Valley Sunday. What's that, Carl?
It's alright, yeah. What's it about?
Well, if you heard, it was a sort of description of, you know, typical suburbia, isn't it?
Here in status symbol land.
You know, it's a sly dig.
When the monkeys get a bee in their bonnet about something,
oh,
you better not.
You don't want to be on the receiving end of that.
Yeah.
We've got a good song on the story later.
Go on, what have we got?
Don't want to tell you yet.
Alright.
Now, is it as pitiful as last week's, where you somehow misheard that Eric Clapton song? What was the Eric Clapton song?
Well, Wonderful Tonight, and he was convinced it was about a broken wheelchair for no reason. No evidence at all. Other than she's walking around with me.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, walking around with me. No, no.
I walk into a room and everyone's head turns.
Yeah.
To look at her, which she didn't seem to.
Helps him to bed.
Is he drunk?
Is
a few.
Oh, never mind.
Yeah, well, you're totally wrong.
Big day, Carl, though, isn't it? Because, you know, there's lots going on, and I know Carl's very important for him, that he champions Live 8.
I don't know what's going on. I don't know what... I am sick of it, to be honest.
Sick of what?
Just sick of reading about it. Sick of this Live 8 thing. Sick of it all.
Brilliant.
Fed up with it.
What annoys you particularly?
It's not only that today, though, is it? On the way in today, right, saw a gay fella.
Is that weird?
On a bike, rushing. What time did the gay march start? What time did it have to be?
Why are you looking at me? I don't know.
No, but he was rushing, left it late, so he'd had a late night again. So my point's right about him.
What was your point about, just to people who've just tuned in?
Well, the fact that they go out late, so you know, they sort of have a nice night out from about 11:30. They're lying in the jeans at like.
They're leather trousers.
But anyway, right? So
they're cutting the back out of their leather trousers about 10:30 at night.
Mum and Ian, right? And I see one stressed out, rushing, right? On a racer, wearing high heels.
Oh, I love you. He's 50's dad. He's never. He's got. He's angry. He's just angry.
If you're a gay fella and you're proud to be gay, but you also want to make poverty history, you don't know what to do today, do you? You're racing all over the place. Murder. It seems a bit unfortunate that they've put them on the same day.
Yeah. Well, you can get little little leather studded wristbands that say make poverty history.
Yeah.
So you know you can join them.
You can kill two birds with one stone.
Yeah.
But why is Live 8 stressing you out? It's probably a good cause. You must have, you know, I know we've discussed this in the past and you don't, but.
I mean, maybe that's the problem. I'm just, I don't know. I mean, I could have told them ages ago that there was no way that they were going to pay it back. I knew that was going to happen.
I love that. But they didn't consult you, did they? When they were handing out this money willy-nilly to people who were dying, you could have had a quiet word with them.
All I'm saying is,
you could have said to Harold Wilson, Harold, don't you.